of what this is. Essentially, it's very simple. It's a microphone that records in all directions. So the front facing, from the public, will be able to hear comments as long as you speak directly to the microphone and to the people up front. The board will, obviously, they're vocal enough for you to hear them. Therefore, the mic in between will catch up all the proper audio levels to have a clean recording. I think the motivation for this is just so everyone can understand what happens at these meetings. The minutes are extremely detailed, and everyone's done a great job with that in the past. This we feel is going to provide the public with the record of the meeting that, you know, I think everyone deserves to have. So initially, we're going to start with the audio recording per this device, have it released on the Lin-Wood website within 3 days of the meeting and available for download from anyone who can access it on the website. We'll then keep the two most recent meetings available, and anything behind the most recent two meetings will be available per request to the school board. And then we can provide it on a as needed basis after that. This is phase one, essentially, of kind of bringing the level of this meeting up a little bit in terms of understanding and communication, the things that I mentioned earlier. There's been some concern from the members of the public that some side talk maybe isn't heard from everyone, that there's maybe some things said that someone didn't hear and they might miss comment or, you know, get the wrong idea about what's being said. So, like I said before, we just want to have a clear record of what's happening here on the public side and on the board side. Phase two is going to be audio reinforcement of this room, which will provide extremely clear audio to everyone attending the meeting. I know, like I said, going back to what I said earlier, there's misunderstandings, people have to repeat themselves. I feel if or when we have individual microphones for all our board members and a public address microphone that can be used by whoever the recognized speaker is of the public. So again, everyone can hear, everyone can understand. It's not an easy process. It's not a cheap endeavor, to be honest with you. It's not overly expensive. It doesn't have to be, although to get beyond where we're at now with nothing but that microphone and speakers in the wall, you have to bridge the gap, right? So like I said before, microphones, mixing equipment so that each individual listener has the same audio levels for each individual speaker in a clean signal everyone can understand. Because, you know, people talk louder than other people, like I said. The side talk as well, you know, we want to make sure everything is recognized. And then once we get to the level of sound reinforcement, then we'll step up the recording quality at that point as well, because we'll have individual line mics to be able to master and mix for a clean audio signal. And again, it's only going to improve once we do that for everyone here in the room, plus everyone who's going to be downloading it, you know, in the future for record. Just real quick, I have...
Director,
Yes.
I would just wanted to clarify the minutes that are being, the meeting that is being recorded, those are not the official minutes to a meeting. So the written document will be the official minutes, just in case anybody wants to know.
Okay. Sorry about that. This is just a handout in regards to audio reinforcement, and there's a lot of technical jargon in there. There's probably a lot of information you guys don't need to read. I just wanted to kind of get this out there and demonstrate what it takes to get to where we want to be. That's why, you know, the quotes we submitted initially, we provided a wide range. I think the range is $3,000 all the way to $12,000 for a system. We could go the $3,000 route. It would function for us. It would do what we need to do. Although we definitely would lose some of the sound quality over time. And as we wanted to build it and maybe stream it live on the web or do a Channel 3 broadcast, the $3,000 gear is not going to provide the level of quality we're going to need to do that. So, you know, in my opinion, we go mid-range. That'll give us the ability to grow in the future with the same equipment as opposed to buying new equipment. And then obviously provide what we need now to get started with the sound reinforcement. But I think, like I said, it's something that in this environment, I believe is needed just for clarity. you know, just for people to understand each other. So that's kind of all I got. If anybody has any questions.
Is this equipment you had, or is this something you had to purchase?
This is a brand new piece of equipment right here. This was grand total $326. This, like I said, this is top of the line equipment right now. These are used by professional journalists. These are used by stage engineers for high quality sound. I consulted with Tom Undersea, who is, as you know, our band director and musical director, but not only that, he's a professional sound engineer as well. So we sat down and vetted a lot of products, and for now, this is our go-to solution for the record, or the unofficial record, as it were. But again, as we progress, this will not go to waste. I can guarantee you that. This can be used numerous applications, whether it's recording a lecture, teacher lecture, student interviews, teacher observation interviews. There's numerous uses for that piece of equipment there that we can use, not only for this purpose. So I think it was money well spent, all told.
Thanks, Chair. Any other questions?
Any other questions?
No, thank you.
Got it? All right. Thank you all very much.
Thanks, Chair.
Good night.
All right, so moving on, I will accept a motion, the approval of the regular minutes from the February 15th school board meeting.
I'll make that motion.
Thanks, Matt.
Second.
Thanks, Tony. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Discussion?
Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry. Questions or corrections?
Yeah,
Jane?
Sure. Great teacher, yeah. It's hard without numbers on the fly. You could look at the minutes, the second page of the second half of the first page. The first page, there we go. The first page, the back side. It said, Matt spoke in regard to their meeting, had great conversation. Administration will work on this, then meet again and report to board. So I just put, just to clarify that a little bit, to clean it up, you were talking about the SRO, right? And administration will work on this. What does that mean? I thought it meant discussing the SRO with the police chief, then meet again and report back to board. Administration will discuss this with the SRO or the committee and report back. Was that it? It just says administration will work on this. I just wanted that. It should be clearly defined, because these minutes represent, obviously, legally, what we talk about. And if it's not clearly defined, if someone looks at that, they're not going to really know. So it should say administration will work on discussing the SRO with, it sounds like you had a committee meeting, with the committee, and then meet again and then report to the board.
So it should probably say administrative team.
There you go.
We'll work on this, because it was brought back to the administrative team, so the administrative team could review it.
We'll work on this
and then report back to the committee.
Okay.
Which
that
is
just,
what happened.
That just clarifies a little bit. Say I'm not on the board and I'm reading this, I'm like, it helps with some people when they're reading it. Had great conversation, I'm not sure what that was about. That was at the meeting, great conversation at the meeting, you mean? So Matt spoke in regard to their meeting and had great conversation regarding the SRO position, period. Was that it?
Right.
Okay. Is that, you got all that?
Yes.
Okay, so the first face of this last page, it says, we said Matt Manning made a motion to strike the word Civil Rights Day and call it Martin Luther King Jr. Day. I would add that in so people have an understanding what that was about. Matt Manning made a motion to strike the word Civil Rights Day and call it Martin Luther King Jr. Day.
That was according to, that was in regards to the calendar.
Yeah, in regards to the 2017, and that says that in regards to the 2017, that 18.
Are you are you asking if that's correct, or?
No, it just, when it says Matt Manning made a motion to strike the word Civil Way Day from the 22nd, and Jalen voted in opposition, majority of the board was in favor, it doesn't say, you just made a motion to strike it, but you had to make a motion to call it something else. You struck, you know what I'm saying? You took it away, but what did you put in? Martin Luther King Jr. Day is what you put in.
Oh, yes.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
But that's not in.
Right, that was said, but you're right.
Right, but it's not in. So if someone reads it and they're like, oh, okay.
So Joanne, can you just make that?
Yep.
So, okay, thanks.
And then, I can't speak for community member, but I don't know if I can or not. But on the second page, I remember Patrick Griffin said he spoke in opposition to removing Civil Rights Day. And I think he mentioned that according to the...
No, I didn't.
You didn't?
I did not say that.
You didn't speak in opposition to the day?
No, I
didn't. I didn't think so. So can you clarify?
Clarification to what?
Right.
What I said was I thought the state called it Martin Luther King Jr. Civil Rights Day.
Right.
I did not speak in opposition to changing it.
I agree. That's why I mentioned it.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay. And that was it. Thank you.
Joanne, you all set with that last
yep.
one? Okay, thanks, Jane. So I'll accept a motion for approval of the regular minutes from the February 15th school board meeting with said corrections from this evening.
I'll make a motion.
Thanks, Matt. Tony, were you still second?
No, I will.
Thanks, Tony. All in favor, aye?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Abstentions? And we do not have non-public, nor do we have return to public minutes tonight, so we're going to push approving those minutes back to next meeting. So we'll move right on to correspondence. I didn't have anything. Did you, Judith?
No, I don't have any correspondence.
Okay. Deb, do you have a business?
Just a couple things. In the packet, there's a engagement letter from the auditors for the,
yep.
the next year's audit. And at the last meeting, and they usually do that after they finish the prior year's audit for the new year. But at the last meeting, Matt had asked that suggest that we bring in the auditors to talk about the audit and the whole process. So I have contacted the auditors, and it looks like they probably our first meeting in May, they'll be able to come in.
That's great.
So if we have any questions, we can, you know, if they do go around to different boards and do that, but if we have any specific questions, we can, you know, give them to them ahead. I will remind you before then.
You said May?
May.
Any questions for Deb?
While you're on the subject of the auditors, Deb, you said that it's that letter of engagement.
Yes.
Are they looking for board approval?
Yeah, we always.
For contract?
Yeah, because we have to sign that. Yeah. The school board has to. Here's the letter.
Do we get quotes from other yes. auditors or? We always just stick with the same company?
We've been with the same company for a while. There's only a few auditors in the state. I have actually talked to some other audit firms. A lot of them aren't taking on new clients because they're so busy. You know, they're already booked by a lot of schools. The state does suggest that we try to do that every once in a while.
Any other questions for Deb? Thanks, Deb. Judy, do you have a report?
Yes. I just wanted to let the board know that the federal gun-free school zones law, that the actual school gun-free school zone law has not changed. The law for carrying a gun has changed. And a person is now able to carry a loaded concealed gun without a license. The law previous to this change was that people could still have a gun without a license. However, now it can be concealed. So the concern or impact of the school is that people coming into the school, we don't know if they have a gun because it's concealed. And there is no way of knowing if they have a gun. So they could, although the law for schools is anyone who has a weapon has to be 1,000 feet away, there is no way for us to know if anyone has a weapon. So that's the impact of any school in New Hampshire. That is the impact that they're going to have now.
Jane.
Are the superintendents going to address that in any way as far as the state of New Hampshire is concerned?
We did try before, so we will continue to work on that with this legislature. We still have another meeting with the legislature update at the end of March.
Oh, good.
So the superintendents will probably express their
let concerns. Us know if there's Senate people on the right senators or anything that we can do to help with making the schools safe that we need to know.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Matt.
Is the intention of that conversation with legislators as a superintendent cohort to amend the law that's been passed, or are you looking for guidance? Is there guidance from the New Hampshire School Board or other attorney groups on how schools should handle this?
We'll be looking at both. I mean, we'll be asking for both because it's in law now.
Right.
We will express the concern, but we'll also express the cost that it could put upon the communities and mm-hmm. the concerns that they have in trying to continue to have a safe environment. So we'll be giving this, we'll express as much as we possibly can to the legislature.
Okay, Matt, again.
I think the biggest concern I have, well, there's a lot of concerns, mm-hmm. But with licensing to have a concealed weapon, there was a process that people had to go through.
Correct.
To make sure that they were in a position to safely...
Competent.
Yeah, competent is a good word for it. And now anybody can conceal a weapon.
Correct.
And our facility is open to that, both facilities.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd certainly be interested in any and all information that comes back.
Oh, absolutely. The next area is the board action. We do have some board action items to take care of, but we can certainly do those during, and it's on the agenda to take care of those board actions. We did have a consumer science room, that's on the agenda. The SRO is on the agenda. The Warren articles is on the agenda. And the only thing that may not be clear is that your policy BEDG, which is your minutes for audio recording, that policy is in second, in your second reading, so that you can now approve, the board can move forward with that policy. And in your packet, I also included in your packet your information, all information culminated from that I received from any group of people or persons or whatever regarding your senior class trip. All of that information and data is included in the packet as well.
Yep, it is.
That's it.
Any questions for Judy? None. Bob?
At our last board meeting, which is the 15th of February, for vacation, our boys ski team had participated in the state meet, and they had finished third, and due to the weather, our girls' meet had been bumped, and that was scheduled after the last meeting. They ended up winning the girls' ski championship, which congratulations to Coach Locks and the other coaches that were involved with him for winning the state championship for Division IV. Also for the service vehicles and the people who drove them to give them a royal escort when they got back from the state championship. So congratulations and thanks to all those involved. Three of our skiers were selected to participate in the Eastern Ski Championships, which are at Attitash this weekend. Viking Bartlett, Zena Bartlett, and Dan O'Connor. So good luck to those skiers as they participate this weekend at Attitash. we also had on the Thursday before vacation, the Invention Convention. which we had the elementary students that displayed their crafts on Thursday during the day and also in the evening when parents were back here. Littleton Courier was really kind to them, and we got some great press from the Invention Convention and the Courier last week, and special thanks to Paula Hood and others who helped in making that possible. I went to Carnival, which took place the week before vacation. We had great weather for that, which was, if we had waited a week, I think we wouldn't have had anything that's quite as good as that. The elementary school ended up with, they were up at the Kank on Friday afternoon, and they had to cut their stay a little bit short because of the rain, but prior to that, the weather was awesome, and thanks to all the advisors and the students and the teachers that helped make that possible. It was a great event. We come back from vacation, we read Across America, which is a week-long event, which is taking place this week. There's a lot of things connected to reading that are in place. A lot of our middle and high school students are coming up reading to the elementary, and there's different events going on in both schools in regards to Read Across America. Caitlin Clark, who was a middle school student, she was selected last year as a Scholastic reporter, and if you had an opportunity to see Chronicle last night, she was part of Chronicle and recognizing her for her work in reporting out with the political elections, and congratulations to Caitlin and for her efforts in receiving that honor. The Wellness Committee scheduled for high school students a wellness day on this coming Friday, which there are two periods in the middle of the day that are going to be used for our high school students to participate in wellness activities. There are a number of students actually have been signing up for them this week. There's a number of community people who are connected to wellness activities in one way or another, crossfitting, yoga, cardio, kickboxing, running, wellness activities. There's a captain over at the police station over here doing a session with females on the high school and rape regression defense system, which is a RAD training for females. There's a number of activities that are going on, and we are fortunate to be able to tap into some of these venues where our kids can participate in that, as well as the people who are donating their time to be a part of that. So that's an exciting thing that we're doing. This month is also Music in Our Schools Month, which is a month of March. We have 17 high school students that are going to be participating in the North Country Music Festival. This year it's up at Profile, which is going to be on the 15th, which is a week from tonight, up at Profile in the evening. And Ms. Dantasi and Mrs. Burhall will be participating with the students up in Profile next Wednesday night. Our annual Music in Our Schools Assembly, which is a K-12 assembly, which we have an opportunity to showcase all of our students that are involved in music. That is on the 22nd of March at 1 o'clock in the afternoon down at the middle high school. Next Tuesday is the 14th of March, is Pi Day, for math, people involved in math. It's a recognition for math and celebration of math. There's different things that we're doing within the school for Pi Day. The middle school, Sarah Woodman is coordinating that at the end of the day for middle school students, where the teachers and staff members are bringing in pies that the students will be able to share at the end of the day. Our FBLA is participating in the state conference on the 23rd and the 24th of March. We have 16 students in addition to two advisors. Faith Clark and Brian Vance were other advisors. Our numbers in FBLA have grown considerably over the past few years, and having 16 students and the two advisors involved with that is a great thing. And lastly, we had two students in our seventh grade, Sydney Pickering and Ethan Wargo, who were selected as scholar scholar athletes for a middle school recognition ceremony. They will be recognized on the 25th of May down in Manchester, along with other middle school students throughout the state, and scholar leaders. So congratulations to Sydney and to Ethan for that. And that's it.
Any questions for Bob? None? Thanks, Bob.
Mm-hmm.
Committee reports. Has facilities met recently, Mike? Nothing to report? Okay. Before we get to policy, were there any other committees that have met recently?
Yes.
Tony?
I haven't had the committee meeting, but I had a question for Mike with facilities. Is there something going on with the gym floor that has become a facilities concern that you're hearing about?
No.
Did you have a meeting down there today?
Yep, not a facilities meeting.
Okay. I'm just curious because I'm hearing this in the community that, you know, there's questions about the condition of the floor. This came back to me late afternoon, and then I hear there was some kind of meeting, you know, at 5:30 today to go over the condition of the floor. And I just feel like, you know, instead of one board member being privy to that, the rest of us should be.
It wasn't just one Vance was in.
Okay. Can I ask, you know, what precipitated this?
A resident complained, or didn't complain, but had concerns about it. Thought that there might be something happening with it. So they brought it to my attention. I brought it to Bob, and Vance got included in it. And we reached out to Jim Young, who was the clerk of the works.
Mm-hmm.
He was available to come by tonight and look at it. Like, you know, to get his opinion on it. And it's going to the company that installed it at this point, but no.
I guess my question, maybe this is to Vance, since you were there, it seems like, you know, as far as I understand policy, that we're not following procedure as far as this goes. I don't know why board members are getting involved in maintenance aspects of the school at this point, and why it's, you know, I understand that a citizen came to you to voice their concern, it then gets put off to administration. Administration should handle it, delegate it from there. It just seems odd that some board members are aware of this and other board members are not. I mean,
we didn't know if there was a concern or not. That's why we
I just understand how certain people get invited to this meeting and other people do not. I guess is my big question. Why couldn't it be left in administration's hands to handle? It's a general building maintenance issue. I mean, am I wrong?
I was going to say, or all the facilities.
Well, even so, I mean, that's what we have facility meetings for, unless it's an emergency situation. I don't think, you know, any board member had to be involved.
There's you have some real, that's a real concern, because it is a policy that we talked about 6 years ago, Matt, when any time a school board person as a school board representative enters the building, you're supposed to have permission from the whole board to do so. And I think maybe this year we voted on that a little, Mike, ahead of time, or 1 year we voted for the whole year to go on issue, like, you remember that?
Yes.
So that is a policy. So there's
but just, I mean, from my end, to clarify, Mike, the concern that Mike got from a committee member he shared with me last week, and he said he was going to take it to Bob. So then Bob contacted me today and asked me if I would join him in a meeting with Jim Young. That I'm not sure when it was set up, but Jim was asked.
Well, last night at 5:00, 5:30.
Yeah. So you may want to vote in the beginning of the year or do it some way to cover yourself as far as policy is concerned, because that would save having to ask every time, because I know that's a pain, but also it would also cover yourselves as far as the school board being aware that you're going in there.
Yeah, no, I agree.
Yeah.
I think for me that's not even the point of it. I don't see how it became a board level issue. You know, where board members were involved in going in and surveying the floor and making a judgment on the floor. I don't know what the qualifications are one board member over the next, but that's what we have, you know, a director of the building to handle.
Is it similar to you figuring out the traffic pattern over here?
Of course it is.
Parking lots, it's totally, kind of that situation, I guess, huh? You want to go there? We'll go there.
Yeah, let's go there, Mike.
You know, you little squirrel.
Yeah, let's
you're a little squirrel.
Let's be civil, Mike.
I ain't gonna be civil. I've had about enough of his bullshit.
Yeah, because you've asked other people to be civil. We can,
just pushing buttons in. We were trying to keep this level and just find if there was a problem. Didn't want it to be blown out. And didn't I tell you that, Bob? Nobody knew. Let's keep this simple.
Why does nobody need to know, Mike? Why can't you just bring it to our attention tonight?
Well, we didn't know if there was a problem.
But that's not up to you and Bob and Vance to decide, is it?
Well,
Where does it say in the policy that school board members, you know, and what do you think as head of facilities, that's your job, but it's not part of the description?
So
you know, if there's a maintenance issue, right, is that what we're talking about?
No, we don't know if it's maintenance. Could be construction issue, could be a lot of things. We don't know. It was pointed out that there was a concern from a resident.
Right, and that has to follow the chain of command. Which doesn't happen.
Chain of command, I contacted Bob. Vance called me about something else. I included him in it.
Okay.
Matt, go ahead. I think Jane makes a great point so that we can avoid these types of conversations and you know, confrontations, that there is a policy that's in place that we get approval before we enter as one or two board members, so that in the future
approval from whom?
The board.
Then let's start meeting every single week so we can do that. And that's part of the problem.
No, it's not.
Part of the problem, guys, is we meet every 3 weeks.
Who should meet every week?
The board. There's a lot of things going on, and we meet sometimes every 3 weeks. You know, I don't feel we meet enough at all.
John, you're not okay.
Yeah. I think the policy is there not to. And not to intertwine the board with the school, and you know, to a point where they're doing more than what they are allowed to do or supposed to do as a board member, which can get you into legal troubles. I think that's the reason. So if we say you all can go on, we're all in trouble. I mean, I've known boards who people have gone in and addressed something in administration with the principal and yada da 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 as a board member, and he was asked to resign from the school board because of that. So it is there. Usually, the policies are there from laws, and they're legitimized, and they're there for a reason. Not to mix the two too much, so you're not sued. So say someone, you know, somebody on maintenance thinks you're his boss, or you're acting like a boss. The whole school gets sued, you know, and I know we've talked about this before, so I'm not bringing up old stuff, but that's what I remember bringing up 6 years ago, too. I'm not saying you're doing a great job as far as I'm concerned. You guys are, like, right on top of it, on it and stuff, but I want to make sure that the district doesn't get sued eventually. And that's a legitimate act, if indeed that's going on, if you're checking, you know, charts about what the maintenance man is doing and making sure he's doing his job, it's like... That's a fine line.
Matt, go ahead. I'm not sure that that's what this meeting was about today.
No,
I know, but I'm just saying. But
yeah,
you know,
but that's why that law is there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, you know, I personally, I don't have any problem with you guys going and taking a look at it, but I think Tony makes a point on making sure everybody understands. Because when you say that you don't want it to get blown out of proportion, I knew about the floor. I heard about, everybody's heard about the gym floor already. So
where'd you hear that?
Just around town. Just like everybody else does.
I didn't, what's
you
wrong?
Know, so there's nothing, well, I don't know. So,
but
you know.
Just informing.
It happens. There's everything that we think that nobody knows, everybody knows, you know?
So. Well, since we're talking about it, I mean, I'll just, whoever the community member was that approached Mike, saw some gaps in the floor. There's a moving piece or piece that was out of line and a chipped piece. And so I'm not sure if it was Bob or Mike that called Jim Young, but Bob invited me today to meet with him and Jim and Mark and Mike. And the gaps in the floor, according to Jim, his opinion was those are expansion gaps that are supposed to be there. They're going to shrink and increase over time depending on the humidity. But every time Jim answered one of those questions, he said, you know, we need to ask the flooring company who's going to come, I guess, next week.
Okay.
Jim said that the moving board, and I believe Mark called the flooring company, told Mark that it was an installation error. It'll be up next week to nail it back down and secure it. And then there was, I only saw one, but apparently there's a couple chips, not really big at all. And Jim Young said that he feels like those are impact chips. Something was dropped or put down hard on it. And you know, he said if he went around with something heavy or a hammer and did it, it would happen all over the place. So he didn't seem concerned that they were flooring issues, that the chipping is just not gonna, you know, you can't stop if someone brings something in there and drops it, but the other issues he thinks is normal. But he advised Mark to contact, I can't remember the guy's name.
Jim Zorris.
Jim what?
Zorris.
Jim Zorris.
Zorbis.
Zorbis. Sorry, I didn't see it back there, Mark. I believe Mark's reached out to him. He's going to come next week. And again, Jim Young, who was our clerk of the works, he didn't feel like there was anything of major concern. So that's that.
Advance.
Tony.
You know, my issue isn't so much with the gym floor, and to kind of piggyback off what Jane said, we've been down this road before.
I know.
As far as making sure we're following the proper procedure, and instead of, you know, we've had these conversations multiple times, and it still happens where somebody says a concerned citizen came to me, and then we need to not take that into our own hands to act, you know, or it's, you know, rather than sometimes we skip over administration, someone comes to the board meeting and says, you know, a concerned citizen complained to me about this. Well, that's where it needs to be handed off to administration. And I don't know the full story, and I don't know how much different board members know about, you know, why the fire chief was here checking on safety issues. You know, I'm pretty sure that wasn't something that was, you know, put in place by administration calling up the fire chief and saying something. You know, as far as I know, that was a citizen. Was that through you as well, Mike?
No.
No?
No.
So the citizen went to the fire chief himself.
Yes. About
you don't know what I'm talking about?
I don't know what you're talking about. The okay.
No. No,
right.
I didn't.
You got somebody out there that wants to speak with you.
I just said yes. I was the one that did it.
Okay. All right.
So can we be filled in about that, the fire chief, and what the discoveries were? Do you know, Vance?
I don't know.
Can you fill us in administration? What the discoveries were with the fire chief, or was there any?
All I know is that the fire chief was called in a couple of times, and he did walk through twice, and he did find some bulbs that were out in the emergency lights, and they were fixed. That's all I know.
Okay, thanks for sharing that. It kind of clear stuff up.
They called him to fix emergency lighting?
I didn't call him. Is that what you asked?
Yes.
Yeah, no, I didn't call him. He just went into the buildings and someone called him, I guess, to come in and look at the lights. I don't know.
Well, Joe just said.
Oh,
he
said
Joe.
He did.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So then that's what he saw, and that's what he recommended to, because we have to keep recordings of everything that the chief recommends. Because he's a health officer. So he did share that when I found out that he did come through Mark, I emailed the chief and asked him for an update, and he gave me an update and I recorded it. As such, so that's, I mean, we have to keep track of that stuff. Is that what you were asking, Vance?
Yeah, I mean, that was it, was just lighting?
I believe it was just the lighting. I guess the fire extinguishers came out, but there was nothing wrong with the fire extinguishers or the schedule that we use to have them examined twice a year.
Okay.
Thank you. You're welcome.
Any other questions before we move on to policy?
I have a quick question about the driver's ed. Should I put that under other business? Yes. Okay.
Yeah.
All
right. Policy, we have two in the packet. IJOC is volunteer policy, and we have that for first reading. Jane, did you want to give everybody a quick?
Do you have it right in front of you?
Yep.
Okay, would you mind doing it?
Yeah, the.
Or Matt, could we.
That's not good. That's
the one I have.
Get used to it. protective. I didn't mind. Well, here it is.
We discussed IJOC-R. It was the policy, the procedure, volunteers procedure. Mm-hmm. And we had decided that what we'd like to do is move it forward to second reading with the volunteers confidentiality agreement attached to it that has the language from the New Hampshire School Boards Association. Is that right? Yeah. So there are no changes to the language other than that addition to incorporate the New Hampshire School Boards.
Matt?
Yes.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but no. IJOC was in the policy committee meeting. IJOC-R was the policy committee meeting. And IJOC were one with the New Hampshire School Board Association verbiage.
That's right. So that would be going to first reading. IJOC-R. And GBCD would be on first reading also.
Sure.
Those two would be going to first reading.
Is it the second one going to first reading?
Background invest. Yes.
I think the only thing.
Background invest. You have something on that?
Yep. I think the only thing that board members got in their packet was IJOC and EDG.
And that is all you should have had because the other went to the policy.
So we're only going to move IJOC to second.
Okay. You're not going to move BEDG?
Yeah, we'll finalize that.
Okay. Yep. Yeah. That's exactly okay. Right. And the other two from today's policy meeting will be on your first reading for next week.
Right.
Yes.
Okay. Any questions on IJOC? Then I will accept a motion to move policy IJOC to second reading.
I'll make a motion.
I'll second it.
Second by Matt. I mean, motion by Matt, second by Jane. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? And then we have EDG. That's up to for approval on second reading. And we saw that last time in first reading. Any questions on audio recordings?
No.
I will accept a motion to adopt policy BEDG as presented tonight. Mm-hmm.
I'll make a motion.
Motion by Matt.
I'll second it.
Second by Aaron. Thank you. All in favor, aye.
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 Opposed? Abstentions? And that takes care of committees. Judith, you have some nominations or resignations?
No, I do not.
You don't? Okay. Next under board action, April board meetings. So, Judith, jump in if what I say is incorrect. Because of the date that the school district meeting falls on, which is March 21st, we need to wait 10 days after that to hold our first school board meeting. So we will miss, we won't be able to meet the fourth week of March.
Correct.
If we meet second, fourth week in April as we normally do, we're going to lose one of those weeks due to April vacation. Mm-hmm. And Judith, I guess it's important that we get two meetings in April. One is a
organizational
meeting, so that would be April 5th. And then the 19th would be a business meeting. Judith is also hoping to have, the plan is by the 9th meeting or before, by the 19th meeting before April vacation, that we have a new principal to recommend to the board.
Correct. That process is going on now.
And if we do that, then the assumption is we would move back to after vacation in May, we move back to weeks 2 and 4 for the regular schedule.
Correct. May you move it back to your second and your fourth.
Right. Do we have to vote to do that? To set those meeting dates? Because it's after the, we don't have a calendar yet anyway.
Right, we don't have a calendar, voted on for the following year. So, as long as the board mentions it, states that it's going to be
it's
the 5th and the 19th.
It's posted, yeah.
It's posted, yeah.
The calendar for next year is out. I thought we voted on that.
No,
school
the
calendar,
board,
not the
school
board.
Board calendar. Oh. Calendar. So does anyone have a problem starting the school board year on the April 5th and 19th? It sounds like we have to do it.
What days? Vacation, April vacation starts on?
April vacation will start, Friday the 21st, school, you know?
Correct.
So, I might not be here the 19th.
Okay.
I won't be here.
All right, and we don't have to vote, so we're...
No.
Okay. All right, next is high school consumer science room.
Back in 1990, there was an account that was set up in memory of Justin Gridley, tragically lost her life in around the late 80s in 1990. There was money that her family had started a fund to be used to help support family consumer science, and she was Justine was very much involved in family consumer science, and there was money that was left in her honor. Over the years, we have made some attempts to try to meet and approve how to best use that money. And there have been some kind of hiccups along the way with that as far as having a need that was connected to what her love was and where they wanted the money to be spent. We have recently taken out, for a number of reasons, our fuel, propane, in the school. We have two gas stoves in our family consumer science room right now, and we're taking the propane out of for that room as well as our science labs. But we would like to purchase two new electric stoves from that money, as well as some other appliances connected to that. Our auditors have indicated to us that it's important that we use that money as soon as possible and to not carry that over any longer. We've been hearing this for quite some time, and we felt that this was an opportunity to purchase something in her name and her memory that would be in line with what was originally assigned to do.
Okay. Matt?
I'd like to make a motion to use monies from the Justin Gridley Fund to purchase two electric stoves.
Thanks, Matt.
I'll second it.
Second by Jane. Any discussion before we vote? Or questions?
Was that Mike Gridley's sister?
Uh-huh. Yes.
Yeah.
Mike, you had a question?
Yeah. Why are we taking gas out now, Bob? We talked about this last 5 years. We couldn't do without it. We talked about this 7 months ago. And it couldn't live without it now. We removed all the gas.
Not in the cafeteria.
No, science labs. I, you know, been on this for 5 years, and I keep being told we can't live without it. And then tonight I'm hearing that it's coming out. What made this happen?
Well, part of, we've had several alarm situations that have led to some potential, potentially some serious situations on the part of evacuating the building and things connected to that with overall safety. The science lab, I know we've had some discussions on that, and I know that Dave Webster has indicated that in the past that he can operate without the propane. The other science teacher was the one that has been kind of promoting it, sticking with it, and we've been reluctant to take the gas out, and we've had some discussions as a result of primarily some of the things with the sensitivity in and around our gas alarms. We've had some conversations with Mrs. McGinley about appliances other than through gas, and I guess we were kind of assuming that that's what she wanted to stick with, and we've had some discussions with her, and she feels that she can operate, appropriately with electric stove. Part of this account that was in the Justin Gridley account kind of played into it a little bit as far as from a financial perspective, and
say you're leaving all the plumbing in, just reading in the bottle, and so if it ever has to be reused, it's going to be there, or?
I don't know the answer. Can I refer to Mark on that?
Sure. Mark, did you hear that question?
Yeah. All the plumbing staying in place, well, the gas piping is going to be capped off. And if they do decide in the future to go, but it's got to be pressure tested all over again.
Thanks, Mark.
I recommend if we do anything to replace the piping. It's so old, it's 50 years old.
I didn't hear that, I'm sorry, Mark.
The piping is left in place because it costs a lot to remove it. It's all being capped off.
Yeah.
But to, you know, the gas lines are, they're old.
Yeah, I imagine. Thank you, Mark.
Any other questions or comments? We have a motion on the floor from Matt, second by Jane. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Next, we have SRO. Matt and Mike, do you guys have an update or a suggestion or something?
Yeah, I guess I'm going to speak on it.
Mike, thanks.
As you know, I kept bringing this up for the last 3 or 4 months at SRO because the money was there, weren't being used. And I was a big fan of SRO, and I made that clear.
Yep.
And so I talked enough, we initiated to have a committee. The committee consisted of Matt, myself, and Judith. We met several weeks ago, and everybody was thinking SRO, and that's how we started out. Then we had a meeting, and all of a sudden we kind of got that SRO out of everybody's heads in the meeting, you know, opened up, you know, to what's available, what we need, because it's, you know, we're talking about the whole community, and SRO, as everybody knows, came as a federal fund when it started, that dried up. So then the community had to fund it, and they've been funding it, but it just hasn't been in place. So we got talking, and in that meeting, we kind of led to a preschool type thing after school, more for be proactive to catch the children that before they come in, because we're having a lot of students come into kindergarten and have, you know, services they need, mm-hmm. because they're not getting, or potentially may not be getting preschool for one reason or another. So in that meeting, Judith said she's going to talk to the administration team and see what they felt about things. And in that meeting, their meeting, which Matt and I didn't attend, but the administration felt that that was a very good approach. It was more worthy than an SRO officer. That they thought they'd see more benefit out of it with some sort of preschool. Now don't start thinking, you know, we're providing daycare, babysitting. We didn't talk about that. We talked preschool. We didn't even get into it.
Academic preschool.
Right.
Yep.
You know, we're not.
Which many schools have.
Yeah.
Yes. And Matt had some information from different colleges that did studies.
Yeah, I'll speak to that for just a moment. You know, and this is very, very, very early, but there's research and data that's available that the achievement gap for children who attend quality preschool and have access to probably quality preschool is significantly reduced by fourth grade. So the thought is that if we can get more kids into a classroom setting, that it may actually help those children stabilize in a school setting and reduce the cost of the district moving forward. But I mean, this is all just kind of, there's a lot of work and research that would need to be done. I mean, this isn't, and there's still other avenues we're looking at.
Like I said though, but we had our committee, we did what we were charged to do. And so we're at the point now where we're looking for direction from the board to send the administration on their way to look further into that.
Well,
Jane,
My thought about this is, it is essentially adding another classroom, preschool, kindergarten. So your the layout of money will be substantial. It's more than daycare. You're talking about certified teachers, and not certified in preschool, I imagine, but
yeah.
People.
Yeah.
So that's one avenue to look at. The other thing is, your agency ahead also provides, there's early intervention. It may have changed from my in community days, but from 0 to 3, there was early intervention programs for folks, and then from 3, school starts diagnosing and assessing the students. However, there is also Head Start that's available to students to do the same, essentially the same thing. Not as probably as cohesive and structured as a preschool, if it's run well, is. However, there are other alternatives for that out in the community. The other thing I saw here was an after-school support program. Now, we have 310 students, K-12. How many preschool students do we have?
Do we have here?
We have 0.
We have 0.
I mean, in the communities.
We haven't gotten, I mean, this is early. I mean,
that's what we're looking for the board right now.
Right.
Jane, we just came
right.
up and would like to charge the administration
right.
to start doing that research.
Right.
Like you said, exactly. Space was
right.
one of the things we talked about.
There's one in Littleton. I don't know if they open it up to other communities if you want to pay to send them up there. I mean, it's in a vocation program. It's a huge structured preschool. They may be at capacity, they only take Littleton students. Instead of reinventing the wheel, I would suggest, I'm not going to be here, that you look at the alternatives. You look ahead, you look at early intervention is another thing. You look at the other students at vocational places that already have preschool set up.
I think it's a long process. It's just a
it
starting
is.
Point.
The other thing you have here is after school support program. There, I don't know, how many kids are in your after school program here?
Well, what we were talking about there, Jane, is we don't do anything from kindergarten to fifth grade.
So there's no
after-school
program?
There's a big gap. There's nothing for them within the school system, our school system.
Well, we do.
We start at fifth grade, so
yeah. We do.
Kindergarten to 4, there was nothing. So that's what we were talking about, trying to do something for those that age group.
Right. Now, I know the Kink does, and some of you might send your kids there. Is that early? We have an opening for 12 in Lincoln. They have an after-school program for 20 kids, and we just expanded it for 40 students.
Yeah, and that was something that they were going to have to go further investigate. Now, we don't know what the Kink is.
You don't want to duplicate services.
Right.
We don't know if that's just activity
time or if it's educational. We're looking at educational.
K-5.
I think it makes it. I would just a point of clarification. Ahead doesn't do this work, but
Head Start. Ahead pays money for Head Start. Doesn't own Head Start.
No.
I'll be darned. I thought it was part of
it. I mean, we do some programs in the elementary schools and in Northern Graphic County
and
Coos, but they're more with financial education and that sort of thing. But I think all the points that you make are great, and I think that's all information that we have to gather in order to make a decision if this is even a road that we head down. I mean,
right.
We have the child care center that does a great job of preschool, pre-K as well.
Right.
But
right.
I don't know that every child has the ability to access. I don't know
right.
what their capacity is. But these are all things that we have to look at, and amongst other things. I mean, for me personally, with Senate Bill 12, you know, I'm starting to have second thoughts on whether we need an SRO here. So, I mean, there's a lot of different things that we're going to look at,
right.
a lot of information needs to be got. This isn't something that's going to happen next year if we do decide to go this road. And there's a lot of people and experts that need to be
Duplication of services. And what I would ask the committee to look at is in school. What do you need in school intervention programs? I just went to a teen summit yesterday. And there was 8,300 students there, but I didn't hear Lin-Wood. I don't know if Lin-Wood, but having monies to do that with our students here, having opiate prevention programs, put it more money into Ahead or more money into intervention assessments, more money into doing assessments of a risk at risk behavior or self to know, risk at self harm or those types of things, and looking inside here in the school.
Yeah.
So
that
would be my
recommendation.
Tony, go ahead. Since we're getting kind of focused on one program, but I think the task of the committee was originally to kind of see if we have a better use for that money that we put aside for SRO. It sounds like that's what they're exploring or asking administration to look for. And I don't know if that's, you know, the decision we're looking to make as a board soon, or, you know, whether we want to have SRO or should be shipping those funds elsewhere.
Well,
I don't know what the discussion was amongst the committee, you know, was the general feeling that, you know, we should be utilizing funds for other programs besides SRO. I mean, that's how this conversation started.
Yes, the administration came back.
Yeah.
Well, they met with the administration team, and they came back and felt that they should be looking at preschool, after school.
Right.
That was more beneficial than SRO. The money would be better spent there.
Yeah, I kind of question. I'm 100% in favor of an academic preschool. I think it's great. I think we should pursue it. I guess my only point of confusion is, I thought after board discussion and after a staff survey, the conversation was going to be geared towards, do we need more counseling, more support services, and more SRO? Are we now throwing all that out at preschool, or are we still with some type of service on the table, Matt?
I just want to continue to mention that this is a very early conversation. All those things that you just spoke of were all discussed, and they all have merit, and there's value to all of those. And I don't think we have picked preschool. I don't want people to get the feeling that we've picked that we need to have a public preschool at Lin-Wood. But that, from the generative conversation that we had,
that was a couple.
It was something that came up, and there was a lot of input that came back. And then when all of the ideas went, we talked about social workers, we talked about other programs at different levels.
Yeah.
When all that information was brought by the administration team to the other part of the group,
right?
They started to focus a little bit more on that piece of it too, the, you know, the early intervention stuff.
Yeah.
But that doesn't mean that this is what it's going to be.
No,
I mean,
no,
this is,
no.
You know.
The after school piece too, I was thinking too, is we inadvertently put people out of jobs by opening up the kink for 40 people. There were daycare providers that provided for my son and many people in his generation that lived in the community and made money off of that. So I think looking at that piece too is also important before you implement it.
Yeah, the economic impact has to be considered.
Yeah.
That's why I'm saying this is conversation.
Yeah.
This isn't.
Yeah.
Well, we are asking the board to charge the administration to start looking also.
Sure.
Get off center. It's been on center now for
so
too long.
Right. So you guys are asking the board to direct Judith to investigate
further.
What part further?
Whatever her administration team feels they should, which they came back and said preschool, after school, but they'd also be looking at the whole picture. Because they have already met, I guess we were told, the administration met after Matt and I met with Judith.
Okay.
We're part of that.
So Judith, is that what administration's thinking is?
Yes, I mean, when I brought it to the administration, I discussed, I shared with the administrative team the concerns that the discussion that was had with the committee, the SRO committee, and that the, you know, they were looking at more proactive preventative measures rather than reactive within SRO. And where the district had, another conversation was where the district had invested in the ADAPT program to expand the ADAPT program, then they, the committee talked about, then if that be the case, then what if we looked at different avenues to go down rather than an SRO? Looking at being proactive in supporting, beginning the support for families at an earlier age rather than waiting until they were five. Those were the discussions that happened. And so that's what the board would be looking at, and then we're not going to go and research all of this if that's not the avenue the board doesn't want to go down, but those were the different, it was very open-ended, you know, it was a very open discussion as to the different components that were out there.
Did you have something, Jane?
If we have a preschool at the community center now, and the school provides services, speech and occupational therapy, speech therapy, and
PT. We don't have a preschool program.
At the daycare center, they don't provide such learning.
We provide for special ed students.
You for special ed students?
Yeah. This was not a special ed.
Yeah.
Discussion.
Yeah.
It was a regular for. Regular discussion.
Yeah, I just
that was just one of the discussions, so that was just one of the proposals.
Sounds like, I mean, I want to move us ahead here, but
Sounds like we're asking the board just to support a very vague.
Mark?
I would say support, I mean, just say whether they want the administration to go down the road of research. That's what it is. Because so many questions and so many components.
Well, what that's telling me is you feel pretty okay with your staff here. You have enough staff to cover all the needs here of.
I'll have to look at that.
Yeah. Oh, you don't haven't looked at.
Okay. I mean, we haven't done any. I haven't done anything. Just brought up the topic. So
okay.
That would be something where, you know, the staff would really have to, would have to go into all that and get it done, as well as look into, you know, keep the SRO on the page as well, and we'll just look at everything and do comparisons to everything. That's what I'm assuming the vote of the committee will want the administration to do.
I still don't know what we're asking Judith to do.
I don't really either.
It sounds like. Go ahead.
I think what we're trying to charge them with is intervention or educational services to the younger students that are entering our school system or within our school system. We have programs like ADAPT for the kids that are middle school and high school and other support programs. What we're looking to do is to focus more on the younger kids and even those kids that may be entering our school system. So it may include investigating the possibility of preschool. Is that?
Yes, that's what we.
Yeah, I mean, that's the direction we want to go. So we're looking for a focus on preschool / elementary educational and support programs to be the focus. And we may come back in 6 months and say it's not, that doesn't make sense. But that's what we at least don't want to have people do all this research if nobody's interested in that.
So we're looking to direct Judith to research different areas of intervention or academic services for younger students from preschool to elementary ages.
That sounds great. That sounds good.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Any questions or comments before we?
I'll make that motion.
Okay, Matt Manning is making a motion to direct Judith to
administrate it.
And her administrative team to investigate intervention or academic services for younger students from the preschool through elementary ages. Thanks, Matt. We have a second. Mike with a second. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? All right, next, under board action, we have warrant article assignments. We just need to make sure everyone's prepared to speak on a specific warrant article at district meeting in case there are community questions.
Starting with number 6.
My assumption is number 6, JJ, Bijou will probably.
Well, usually the budget committee does get up there first.
Yeah.
But
who
was anyone?
Budget rep? Aaron, were you budget rep?
I am.
Yeah.
So after JJ is done, if there are any other questions, if you want to kind of be our speaker for Article 6.
Okay.
And maybe reach out to JJ ahead of time and just, you know what he's going to say. I'm assuming he's going to almost repeat conversations from budget hearing. Article 7 is?
Teacher's contract.
Teacher's contract, we should have a negotiator, John, Jane, or Aaron speak on that. Jane, it's your last hurrah.
I'm going to speak on Jane.
Do I have a choice?
No, I mean, you, John, or Aaron.
Aaron, you go ahead.
Aaron just took one, though. Maybe it's your
choice. Well, I mean, I'll take it if Jane doesn't want it. Just let Jane move it to say.
All right, thanks, John. Article 8 is $95,000 for the gym roof. We want a facilities, I don't mind speaking on it, but if a facilities person who has a little more knowledge. Traditionally, we don't have anybody who questions our structural projects. I guess
I'll do it. 8.
You want 8? Okay.
Sure.
Article 9 is $45,000, continuing the flooring project. I can do that. That's just same product, I assume, possibly.
Mm-hmm.
Article 10 is, do we need people to speak
10 through 14 are your
trust funds.
Trust funds? Typically not, and we have a lot of information in the annual report that you can refer to.
Okay.
I mean, you might want to just be prepared just in case there are questions. But
is the annual report out?
Not yet.
I mean, what if there are questions, I can speak on all the trust funds. I don't mind doing that. I mean, they're, it's almost a preventative maintenance account so that we can reduce the budget. I actually just did my chair report the other day, and there were a lot of facilities items I mentioned that we had done with trust fund money rather than put it into this budget. So I think when people read those things, they understand it, but I can definitely speak on those, all of them.
Well, I think, too, typically if people have questions, they usually have questions on what the balance is of those accounts.
Right, and that's in the report, too, which we can refer to.
Yeah, they can just refer to, if I don't have it handy, you can just refer to your DIM. No, it's pretty late. Any questions on warrants? Jane,
no. No, I'm just thinking, I thought for sure.
No. New business, we had Trey. He was our first, so thank you, Trey. For setting us up with that. Jane, you had something for new business?
I did. I was just wondering about Driver's Ed and how that's working out first for the students, and is that coming up flat? Budget is supposed to, you said it wouldn't cost the district anything. I wondered if that was indeed happening.
I didn't miss something here. The Driver Ed program, we did have one this past summer, and there was interest from students and families to have another Driver's Ed program, so we follow the same process we did last year.
Okay.
And we have 15 students currently in a Driver's Ed program, and we rent the vehicle from the a car dealership in Littleton.
Right.
And we just contract it for that amount of time.
Yeah.
And then it and then that's the end of it. And it costs less for the students to go. It's students from Lincoln and Woodstock.
Right.
And it costs, it's less expensive for them to do it here, and with the expenses, everything evens out. It's no
cost to the district?
No cost to the district. No.
Okay.
So it's based on 15 student capacity, and it runs 6 to 8 weeks.
Okay. So far the district hasn't incurred any costs. How much do the students pay?
I think it's $550. $500.
That's what they charge us.
$550? We've been trying to run them since last summer. We've been trying to, on several occasions, have tried to have sign-ups for a class,
mm-hmm.
and our numbers have been low. There's a stipulation that they have to be a certain age by the time the class ends, so
16.
We kind of keep bumping it, so we finally hit the magic number that allowed us to start this last week.
With
the
15.
We didn't think we were going to be able to do it, and we ended up having some students that just got in under the wire for a day while we were able to do it.
Oh, good. Yeah, I think I saw somebody trying. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you can tell because they actually pulled over and stopped when the fire engine went by. I'm like, I said to Steve, we're supposed to stop or just slow down. I don't remember. You say, it must be stopped because they are. You forget so many years of driving. It's like, I know I had to pull over. Thank you, Bob.
Mm-hmm. Can I just back up real quick on warrant articles? What year is this going to be on flooring project? Is this the fourth year?
Yes. I put that in the report.
Okay.
Can I ask Vance about something?
Sure.
Okay. The 20-hour a week tech person, what happened with that? I know what happened with that, but can you explain how we got to where we got?
Right, only
because I know somebody that applied for the job, didn't get an interview, didn't get called back to just recently, and then was told that I guess we have a senior group.
Correct, we do. What happened was that the applicants that were followed the same process with all applicants for any position. When applicants send in their resumes and a letter of interest, the SAU returns a communication to them stating the outcome of what is going to, the process that's going to be followed and the outcome. And all applicants were, you know, given that same information. Currently, in the meantime, what had happened was students became interested in an ELO position within the school, working with the computer system with Dre. So what they ended up doing was looking at students helping the program for now, and that seems to be very successful on the student side, and Trey's working with the students that are involved in that program. So rather than bring in somebody this year, we ended up working with students. Next year, this next summer, we will put it out again and see what applicants we have that, you know, apply for the position.
Can I ask how many applicants we have?
Two.
Okay. Can I ask, well, I will ask, why was this amount of money not cut from the budget if we knew we were going to the seniors?
Because this was, we didn't know at the time when we did the budget. This just happened recently.
I'm still very much, just not to speak out of turn, but I'm still, still very much in the market for a qualified assistant. Like I said, having only two applicants, I didn't find the range of experience between either one of them to be what we needed right now. The reason the money stayed in the budget, as far as I'm concerned, is that the need still exists for extra tech help. But again, I believe it's contingent on the correct skill set and the needs that we have moving forward. I think I was very fortunate to find a junior and a senior that were able to fill the need, my immediate needs for the peripheral busy work, as it were, to get us over the hump for this year. And like Judy said, we're going to be reevaluating the need over the summer, and I hope to have someone in, you know, as a part-time professional starting for next school year. So I didn't, I did not want to remove the money from my budget, considering the need still exists. And quite honestly, if I can find a part-time professional that fits the needs and, excuse me, the student work program is not going away either. Like I said, these guys have been tremendous for me, and I hope to build that program over the years here and get as much student involvement as we can to support the other students. That's the end goal with the work program.
All right, that's fine. I just was wondering if you're replacing this position with students.
No, sir.
Fine.
No,
we're saving money.
And I understand that, and that's why I say, like, I consider myself very lucky to have the access to, you know, numerous bright students besides the two that are helping me right now that are eager and, you know, can definitely fill that bottom niche for me with support.
So the two applicants weren't qualified, is that right?
The first applicant was a matter of schedule conflict with their current position. The applicant I think you're referring to to be honest with you, they were a bit more qualified in the sense of different industry. I was looking for more of, you know, a vanilla palette when it came to support and their experience in support, so we could craft it and mold it into an educational position ultimately. So, like I said, once we post it again, and this gentleman is more than welcome to reapply.
I'm not single out anybody.
No, not at all. I'm just stating, you know, those were the two.
I would have assumed
two applicants and the two discrepancies.
Judith would have brought up at a meeting, we had two applicants for this position. We're reviewing. I guess it's lack of maybe a little communication from you to us.
Well,
and maybe we don't get informed when we, I don't know, how did that go for us? I mean, I would assume that when Judith would say, I got two applicants for this position, we're reviewing it now, and then, you know, maybe not. I mean,
no, you're right. That's what
we should have.
You wanted
as
to
a
know
board member, I would have liked to know that there were two applicants for this position. Then if we went forward and, you know, the administration decided to do what you did, I guess it would have been,
Judy,
I would have been better prepared for
absolutely. And again, I have no problem sharing that information in the future, and, you know, as a whole, as we move forward. So that's noted.
If that position is re-advertised, is what it sounds like is going to happen in the summer, will you reach out to the two applicants and
absolutely
let them know that it's open again?
We could do that.
Okay.
Yeah. Still advertised today on the website.
Yeah, the website was still advertised. It's kind of like the same thing with the custodians that we have. You know, it'd be nice to know that we've had five applicants, we're reviewing them now, and if none of them are qualified, then that's fine.
I would just make an assumption that if somebody does apply for a position, no matter what position it is in the school,
yeah,
that we keep their resume and their application
on
file, so that if I'm,
year,
you know, to compare
year.
Other things,
yeah.
I would assume so. If it's,
yeah,
you
we
know,
keep
under
all
constant.
On for a year, that's what's required.
Okay.
Yeah, and again, I welcome any, if you guys know anyone who's interested in that position, please send them my way. I mean, it's not a heap that's going to go away. It's only going to increase in the future.
Okay. That's what I was going to ask you, Judy. Would it decrease and go back to one person after a while once the teachers are used to everything? But that's what I was thinking.
Like I said, my objective is to grow that into an educational position, as in a tech integrator, and get someone in who's going down that path, and then we can utilize the skill set, the technical skill set, and then bond that into more tech integration within the classroom.
Thanks, Trey.
You're welcome.
Any other questions on that tech?
Thank
system?
You.
You're welcome.
Continuing business, we have senior class trip. Everyone got a packet in their packet. The administration put together things that they found. Board members were asked to send other things that they had in to Judith, and I guess we're just gonna. I don't know how this is going to go. What do people think after reading?
I think we should take really good notes here. If it's going back to the policy committee, if I can, Chair, because you're going to be reviewing it after. Do you want to have succinct notes about what the board has suggested and not suggested?
Yeah. I mean, okay. What we have here is we've got our policy. We've got everything
yeah.
from legal opinions to professional businesses to just some correspondence in here from other school districts and what they do. I guess I'd like to start by opening up that people have opinions right now on the way we should go with this. I'm not asking the policy itself, just where should we go with the whole trip.
Can I ask where
we opened up a can of worms, you know, you gotta deal with this.
Well,
we've been, I mean.
At some point you gotta put chocolate on and get it done and close it up. Can I ask by the first question, I guess would be the first one, is the one that Tony brought up regarding having advisors or not having advisors on the trip. I guess information about that, but just not having the school be part of it. My understanding from the reading that I had, that I think we should keep it within the school district because we're liable regardless or not, from some information that I read that Judy provided. You had mentioned that the students doing it on their own without having school advisors. I would suggest that we continue with the way it's going based on the information I read regarding, we can still be sued. If you all read that information, clearly you can't separate yourself from the kids who are out there. Legally, that's what I found, so.
So Jane, Jane, your take is the current fundraising policy and the trips currently go the way they're going.
Not necessarily keep the current funding policy itself, but just the question on the table that Tony can reiterate because it was his question, should we even have, and you said, well, maybe that's an idea, we'll think about it. Should we even have the advisors,
sponsors.
Thank you for that. That's the word I was looking for, sponsored through the school. And you said, yeah, well, that's an idea. People may think differently. I'm thinking that we should continue to have it sponsored because it's well received, it's well liked. Obviously, the advisors are really into it. Instead of taking it off the table, and we're still responsible strategically wise from the readings that was provided to us through administration.
So your opinion is keep it school sponsored within
yes.
the school, and then you know we just have to go back to what is the fundraising policy going to look like.
So I guess we should decide first, do we want to keep it school?
I just want to get everyone's opinion
yeah.
first. So
sure.
Matt,
yep,
you had to hear that.
Yeah, I just, you know, through this whole process and the months and hearing from the advisors, hearing from some of the students, and taking everything into consideration, some of the concerns that I've heard over the time ranged from inclusion of all the students. It ranged It's a flexibility of being able to go where you want. It cost savings so that you didn't have to have a travel agent, or should we have a travel agent present? Liability concerns, and I think I read everything in the pack, and I think I have a different opinion as far as liability. I think the school attorney in one of the pages says, provided that the board or district does not spend funds on the trip, and makes it clear that it's not sponsoring the trip, an outside group could plan and take the students on a trip. So from my perspective and my position, and this wouldn't necessarily affect the students that are in the high school right now, in order to provide the flexibility and the cost savings that some have brought to us, and in order to satisfy the liability concerns on the other side and the inclusion concerns, I would recommend that we do a school-sponsored trip, something small, a one-day thing somewhere, whether it's Six Flags, wherever, and it comes out of district funds and it's school-sponsored. But then allow others, if they choose to put together a trip for the students, and they can run it however they want. And that it would be clear that they sign a piece of paper that says that this isn't, that it's clear that it's not a school-sponsored event.
Well, so basically you're just adding another trip. Because right now we don't sponsor, the school doesn't sponsor the senior class trip.
No.
The sponsor isn't like support, they support it. Not right.
I'm trying to take an approach where that would satisfy the inclusion component of it. It would satisfy the liability component, and then having another trip on the outside. If somebody wanted to do something more grand, then they had the opportunity to do that as well.
So you're saying the students continue to raise funds the way they are today?
The no. One trip? Is that what you said? Okay.
No, I mean they would that may be the approach that they take to doing it, but it wouldn't be school sponsored fundraising events.
So where's the ones you said school-sponsored trip, one school-sponsored trip?
I think what Matt's saying is he's supporting more of a day trip.
A day trip.
One day.
Or an overnight for that the school would sponsor, pay for.
Oh.
However we do it.
The district pays for it?
That the district, it's school-sponsored, the district pays for it, whether it's partially through fundraising, class dues, however it is. But it's a smaller scale, one day, the whole class goes somewhere, maybe it's an overnight. If somebody wanted to do something more grand, advisors, whoever it be,
okay,
and
so
put something together.
I just want to get this. Also, school sponsorship for one night.
Yep.
And it's paid for by fundraising.
Well, however it's configured.
Not a tax agency.
Maybe not. But that's fine. I'm just telling you my opinion.
It could be.
It could be partial. However it's decided to do. Because there's school trips that happen all the time.
Okay.
Not school trips. There's trips where students go on through. Being put together through teachers in the school system.
And allow
and put,
other
But
trips.
They're not school sponsored.
That's right.
Okay, so allow
So that allows
trips.
The flexibility for those who want to do something bigger and more grand to spend the money however they want. It gets off of our books. We have no liability as far as accounting and auditing, which has come up in the last couple of audits. It has nothing to do with the school.
So the money, say you do this, which...
Yeah.
The money they raise goes into their own account at their own bank.
We have nothing,
we have
do
nothing
they
to
want
do
with
it.
But they're parents, and they need to know and sign off on something that this is not school sponsored.
Exactly. I get it.
So there is no liability to the district as long as that's recognized.
You're basically going back to what I recommended quite a while ago, then, that they go out on their own and do what they want.
Yeah.
As far as fundraising and everything else, that's okay, that's fine. But think of the other aspects here. So you're not going to have class advisors. Why would they... They're going to be doing it on their own. So think of the other components you're going to pick up. You just went through when accountable and that. And advisors, parents put in a lot of time on that.
Sure.
So somebody's going to pick that piece of the pie up.
Well, I don't think necessarily.
Other things too.
Yeah.
Oh, that's fine.
I
brought that up quite a few meetings ago. Go on their own.
If I could read some legality too for you out of this, it says, the school district required parents to waive legal claims against the school district prior to the student's trip traveling. The school also sent medical advice for trip, including link. They, however, got sued for $41.5 million. Someone slipped and fell. In some, the MUM case, it was called, calls for reiteration of an earlier warning made in this outline. The only way to avoid entirely any risk or liability on a student trip is to eliminate student trips.
Right.
So you're going to eliminate student trips?
I'm not proposing we eliminate student trips.
Then we're not eliminating liability.
Not completely, no.
No, no, you're not.
Or just have something here for them that.
So that, to me, is $45 million is $41.5 a lot to be sued for.
I mean, I listen to what Matt says, and Bob, go ahead.
Well, I don't see how you can raise money, how kids can raise money and not have it connected to the school. You know, I don't think that that's possible. I mean, you go up to somebody's house, what's this for? Oh, I'm a junior at Lin-Wood School. I mean, I don't think you can raise money if you're a student that way without it being connected to the school.
I don't think you can.
I don't see how you can do that.
I think it makes it harder.
Well, I don't see if you can do it all. I mean, you're gonna be connected to the school, and to me, that's a liability issue.
You're talking liability.
Absolutely.
Right. You're never gonna remove yourself from the liability end. You're trying to limit your exposure to it.
Right.
Well, you're never gonna remove yourself. I mean, you're just
unless
never.
You don't do it.
So if we're not, then we should have controls over it, so we can at least say we attempted to eliminate, you know, make it safe and for the kids. I mean, walk it away from me, and my eye doesn't eliminate me. You know, doesn't make sense to me not to have any ordinances or whatever, not ordinances, I'm saying the wrong word, but have any responsibility in it and say, okay, to make it safe, this is what you need to do. You need to get vaccinations before you go over to third world countries. You need to do this. And say, we're just going to leave it up to the kids. And then, to me, that's very dangerous as far as wildlife.
All right, Can I just go ahead? I don't think necessarily if it is a non-school sponsored trip that there can't be some fundraising components or access to school activities or functions for fundraising that makes it a school trip. There's other schools that allow advisors or sponsors of trips to do fundraising on their campus or at events, even though it's not a school sponsored trip. They get permission to do it. So,
I mean, you can.
There's a lot of different things you can do.
I'm not saying we're going that way, but if someone were to go that way, there's nothing wrong with a group of individuals who are, quote unquote, not connected to the school, filling up the proper paperwork and doing their own stand at homecoming for doing the proper paperwork through the office and doing whatever during events at school. I mean, there are avenues they can go.
I guess I haven't heard the real reason why we even went down this road to begin with. We heard that Primex, and then that was proven that wasn't the reason. So why are we even messing with it?
Tony mentioned it. We
talked about this for over a year.
Right.
Okay. Vance, I think that...
Tony, go ahead.
Yeah, I think that it probably should stay as a school-sponsored trip. You know, I think looking through all the research that administration did with, you know, the seven neighboring school districts and what they do, you know, everybody's keeping it, you know, being a school-sponsored trip. And as Mr. Nelson pointed out, we really can't send or have students out there trying to solicit funds without it somehow coming back and being connected to the school. I think the other thing that the research bears out, you know, is that it's a much smaller scale than what has been traditionally going on here. You know, I think most of these trips, actually all of them, except for maybe the exception of Pittsburgh, which probably has a senior class with maybe 8 kids, they're doing a trip that's more in line with this year's outgoing seniors, you know, whether it be the 2-day trip, you know, something like Matt mentioned. I think that's really what we should be focusing on to really work on the inclusivity of the whole thing. You know, we talked about, you know, what's the whole purpose of having a senior class trip? You know, where did it originate from? What purpose does it serve? And it seems that at some point, in my opinion, it always should be about kind of like the last hurrah for the senior class.
Yeah.
We all know the harsh reality of when you graduate high school, 2/3 of your class you may never see again. You may never communicate with them. You're not going to fraternize with them. This is a great opportunity to kind of have that going out moment with your class. And it's great to have everybody there or pretty close to everybody there. When you're looking at a 6-day trip that requires X amount of dollars, you know, and you end up with 50% going, which we've had in the past. We've had less than 50%. You know, just a few years ago, we had, you know, 2/3, but 1/3 had to kick in extra money that, you know, wasn't fully funded, even though it was for 1/3 of the class. You know, I think that's kind of the direction I personally feel we should be going towards. I think it's great to keep it school-related. You know, we talk about the liability issues that we cannot get away from, you know, and don't know how much people look through the Pittsburgh policy, that they have a very detailed policy. Mm-hmm. You know, we talked about staff supervisors, and maybe, you know, we should get away from having any supervisors slash advisors that are not employees of our school. I don't know if that's going to, if that limits us as far as, or limits our liability. You know, when it's school employees overseeing everything rather than school employees and non-school employees making decisions for our children and financial decisions for them as well.
John, can I get your take?
Me? Yep. My take was the system wasn't broke, so why play with it? I mean, that's kind of where I come from. Yeah, and I agree with Mike. Where did this start? Who started this? What started this? And you know, it's almost like one class is jealous of another class because one gets to go to the honors and one gets to go. And I don't want to reiterate what we've been talking about for years. But that's the hard thing. And my component is what started this. One class is always going to raise more than the other. You know? I do a little bit maybe agree with Matt that, you know, let them have something here, one night here in the gym, get together, dinner, whatever, school pays for it, big sit-down dinner, whatever. And then if they want to go on the trip, it's their money, they can go do it with what they want.
So, my understanding is from you and Mike, you're saying just leave it the way it is.
John,
you're saying leave it the way it is. Because we don't know what starts, so leave it the way it is. Okay.
Well, no, John said he actually agrees with Matt.
Yeah.
One small scale trip.
Maybe not even an overnight, but just like a dinner here, or get together in the gym, or a dance, or music, or what a little thing paid for by us. And then that's their money. They can build
in the district.
Vance, can I throw? Yeah, throw out a question. You know, we talk about, you know, John talks about how the system wasn't broken. Some people take a $40,000 trip. Some people take a $10,000 trip. I don't think it's so much about jealousy. I do think you do get into situations where some people get competitive about trying to outdo maybe the last class that was before them. But I think, you know, maybe to do a little, you know, insight into ourselves, you know, what are we trying to accomplish from having a senior class trip? But what is the grand benefit of going to the Bahamas? Where's the educational benefit in that? You know, we say that there needs to be an educational component to all our field trips.
Sometimes just leaving the town of Lincoln's educational. I mean,
well, they can do that as adults, you know? Right? They can do that as adults.
Yeah, exactly. But
I think the key word here is that it's a field trip, not a vacation. That's
so, Aaron, where do you fall on this? What's your take?
Well, I agree with Tony and. You know, I mean, just speaking from experience, I'm probably the youngest one here, but I graduated in 2003, and we had a one-night vacation where we went to Six Flags, and then we stayed overnight, we saw a Yankees-Red Sox game the next day, and then we went home. And it cost us, I don't know, $7,000, and it was really, really simple, and it was a field trip, not a vacation. It was a school-sponsored event for the students, not an extravagant trip to. It's too much. I feel. I mean, I know I haven't spoken much about it, but for me, I think going on a 6-day trip is ridiculous, and you know, our students should be raising money and putting that money to better uses than going on a vacation.
So it's too much money.
It's just too much.
Okay.
Mike, what's your official opinion?
Well, I think it's fine the way it is, and these students come into freshman year knowing what they're looking at, and if they choose to work hard and raise the money, they should have the opportunity to spend it as they choose. If you choose not to participate and you don't get the participation point to however they do it, then you got to kick in a little bit. That's life. I mean, nobody said this is a free ride. They know going in what the ground rules are. Why should I participate 80%, 90%, you participate 10 and get to come along for free? That ain't how society works.
Yeah, but would you compare us to the other schools? I mean, in our packets we have all the, you know, the at least, what, seven other schools?
Yeah, those seven. Let's look at another seven. We can hand-pick them and find some that go other places, Aaron, which they do.
I know, but I'm just saying it's absolutely ludicrous to focus your attention on raising thousands of dollars to go on spring break, essentially, is what I feel it is. It's not a field trip at that point. It's spring break. And it's just ridiculous. And it doesn't teach our kids to do anything other than, let's raise a lot of money to go away for a week to somewhere sunny and happy. You know, it's not something that brings the kids together. It's essentially, like I said, it's a vacation, a spring break of sorts. It has nothing to do with a senior class trip at that point. Mm. And it teaches our students that was the point of our trip. It's ridiculous to me.
Vance, you didn't...
No, after listening to everybody, I kind of like what Matt and John have said. Let's have the school sponsor. Matt said maybe a day trip or one overnight. John said it could be even as small as an event. Have the school sponsor financially and let the kids and the people in the community who want to do something else do something else. But as I say that, I know that John and Matt and I agree with that. Sounds like Tony and Aaron think it should stay school, but way smaller. You would like it school, but change fundraising somehow, and Mike likes it the way it is, and I hate to say this, I don't think we've made any progress.
Well, we have. I think we all agree that a part of it should be school-sponsored. So I do agree. I don't agree you shouldn't use district money, actually, but I think that fundraising so the kids can earn something, I do agree with that piece of it. So I think we've all agreed, at least it's school-sponsored, in that it's going to come back and reflect, and there'll be guidelines to follow.
Matt, let me ask a question. Is it easier for a student to raise, and I don't know all the fundraising requirements, it doesn't really matter to me, but is it easier for an individual student or all individual students to potentially reach the maximum if the number's lower? So if it's not a $20,000 trip or a $15,000 or a $40,000 trip where each person needs to raise $2,500 or whatever it is,
yeah,
would it become more inclusive then if the fundraising goal for each student was something on a smaller scale?
Well, if you had
like a $500 or $600 or $700 or $1,000,
whatever. Some of these trips were gold. The greatest trip in this packet was like $20,000, which would be, $700 a year is like $15,800, seven a year per student. I think I did that before.
700 for a total fundraising goal.
Per year.
Yes, for the 4 years.
So
per
seven
student.
Times, say 20, I typed in 20 students. You get 15.
You're not talking per year, you're talking per 4 years.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's
20. So what's...
Yeah, it's 20. So you're better. I don't have a lot of money to figure out. But yeah.
No, what's 700 times 30?
700 times 30?
$21,000.
Yeah.
$21,000. Yeah, I think we've talked about the cap, the fundraising cap in
right.
the past.
Yeah.
And, I still think that's the way to go. You know, when we scale down the trip to something that's going to be fully inclusive or, for pretty close to it or open to being fully inclusive, that is not a vacation, not a dream vacation for these kids, but actually a bonding opportunity. I think when you look through your packet, Gorham had a fantastic trip, 2-3 days, two nights. The first day, they're doing two things together. The next day, they have their choice of activities, and then, regrouping after that. I think, we've thrown around numbers, and I don't have the numbers in front of me because I figured this out for past trips, but we were in that high $700 to $800 per kid fundraising.
Yeah.
That's why I think we should be talking about a cap of about $500. If you've got 30 kids and you have a cap of $500, it's $15,000. And if you tell me that you cannot do a quality trip for $15,000, you have bigger issues financially.
So, Jane, it sounds like And they're taking some notes with it. Sounds like everyone wants something school-sponsored, whether it's one day, one evening, one week.
I think we all agree that we should have some, you know, obviously.
I
do agree. That's what I heard.
That's a true statement, right?
Yes.
Okay. I think the next step is just, I mean, we've been dragging our feet for a year. I think rather than discussing it at policy, I think whoever is on policy in April, when we have a new board, we need to bring a policy to first reading.
Right.
And, you know, if it gets voted and we have a different policy, great. If it gets voted down, we'll go back to the drawing table. But I don't feel like, I mean, do you agree? I don't feel like we've made any progress in terms of where we stand other than right now. We all agree it should be something.
Well, I mean, we agree that they should have it.
We haven't done much other than talk about it.
Well, that's okay. We're still talking about it. And I agree. I think there should be a cap, but I think it should be higher. I think 20,000 is fine. I think that kids should be allowed to travel only because a lot of our kids in Lincoln don't get that opportunity to travel. And when they travel, they used to go to Costa Rica. And, you know, that was one of my son's favorite trips in the world. So I think taking them out of small town, letting them travel places, and educationally wise is very valuable. And I think we have almost an $8 million school, and I don't want to tie the kids' hands and say, okay, you can't have this great trip. We have an expensive school to begin with. I mean, if you're looking at it that way, as you said, we're wealthy. I don't believe that, but you said it once. Somebody said it once. We're wealthy districts. So I think 20,000 would be the cap that I would put on it.
Matt.
So I guess my question would be at this point, how does that satisfy if we were to go come back with a policy that had some sort of limits or caps to it? How does that satisfy the liability piece, which I thought was one of your concerns early on in our conversations with travel, bringing in the travel agent, that sort of thing? And how does that satisfy?
Well, because Primex covers travel agencies, we have documentation on that, so they could go to a travel agency.
So are you suggesting then they would use it? They would be required to use a travel agent?
We have to have it covered by Primex, so I would follow Primex's policy, and it does say that there are certain travel agencies to use, but I want to make sure we're insured, and they get the regular shot seat. That way we have more control over that kind of stuff. The other piece I thought was initial concern was the discrepancy between the classes in that, the way the money is spent, not taking it out first, some other issues, that by policies, you can tighten that up, just like they have in the other schools. The policies are the dates and the itinerary are all tightened up. What do you bring to the school board? It's all tightened up in the policy. And that's pretty much what they do already, but it's not written down. So it would stop the advisors from saying, no, I'm going to do this, and you can't come. And I do agree with Tony. I think everybody should be included regardless myself, because it's the educational. When you travel out of Lincoln, go north, south, you're educating yourself. I don't think people should, like how many mums you sell should be an indication whether you get the opportunity to fly or go somewhere. I don't think that is fair to me, because I don't think kids even know this. They learn about work when they're out there starving. You know what I mean? I don't think it's a big deal with that piece of it. That's my thing, but those things I would look at as a board. I would look at those things, because I do think everybody should have the opportunity to do them. I don't think someone who goes home, and I mentioned this before, I bought all my son's stuff, and he went on everything. But people go home, and they don't have parents who can buy five things of mums, and they can't go. You know, I think it's discriminatory. And I don't think it teaches the value of work, all that. It does somewhat, but I think too much emphasis is given to it, so too much importance is given to it in this particular. The best thing they can learn is to travel. You know, they'll sell moms when they have peanut butter and jelly. They'll learn work.
So are you saying that if, I just want to make sure I'm clear on what you're saying. So are you saying that if it was $20,000, which you're comfortable with, but that every child, every student goes?
I would hope so. Yeah. And then if someone travels, they think, oh, I might want to get a job later so I can travel and do something besides stay. And like, and I don't want to say that because a lot of people
say that.
I
think that would be difficult. They didn't work.
Right. I think
to,
that would
to get the money, I think I would say, what can I do to get another free trip?
Not necessarily. I think it will open their eyes. I think a lot of emphasis is placed too much on the importance of adolescents learning this stuff when they're 15. They don't even know what, you know, the brain doesn't even develop till you're 25. I think too much emphasis is put on that. I think they should be allowed to explore their world and that kind of stuff. I think that's more educational.
Matt?
I guess I'd like to hear more from administration on their feelings on liability and also from an accounting standpoint, because it's something that's come up in two audits in a row, right? Two or three audits for the funding and how that's handled.
Well, it does take time to police the money. And that is time that is spent policing the money, and in some cases it the policing the money wasn't enough, because, you know, there were situations where the auditor did recognize that there were processes that were not followed.
What are the processes that are followed? I mean, if they raise money, don't they deposit it through the appropriate school account?
It's supposed to, but it sometimes it does not get that. That does not happen, and we're not aware of it until after the process was not followed. We found out about one of them when an outside agency called us and said the process was not followed, and we found it and we corrected it. But that's the policing part. And there's been discrimination with students with disabilities, and it wasn't found out until the last minute. So, you know, those are real, real issues.
Issues, yeah. Those are
federal issues.
Yeah, they need to be tightened up in policy.
That cannot happen. We caught it, but it was 2 weeks before, so there was a lot of running around at the SAU to make sure that was corrected and the child was protected.
Yeah, so you have to be careful about not discriminating for poverty reasons too.
Right.
If they can't afford it, well, you could have sold.
That's more covered in here, Jane, under the law, right?
I don't know.
I thought I read if somebody receives free or reduced lunch.
Well,
yeah,
it's
required. That hasn't been followed.
Oh,
it's required
it?
To be paid for.
From what I read, Jane.
Oh, lunch free and if they receive.
If somebody qualifies for free or reduced lunch, which is probably 50% of our population.
No, it's not that high, is
you
it?
You don't think so?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
That's the whole North Country.
Close to it.
Yeah, it's pretty close.
It's 48. That's right. That's what you said.
So under the federal law, from what I read, those people, those students.
For regular field trips, that's true.
But not.
Says,
but there's fundraising involved here.
Okay,
which
so that
could change that a little
could
bit.
Change
for
that.
Our regular field trips. If there's a fee or something, and if there's a student that cannot pay, it's just like tests. If they have to pay for a test, like the PSAT,
yeah.
They can't pay for it, they're on free and reduced. There's money available for that. So, but anyway.
Do we know that for sure?
Yes.
There's a difference. No, no.
What's
this
name, Mike?
There's a difference between a field trip and a class trip.
Well,
no, it's the way the funds are raised.
Says
it's in your
extracurricular activities.
What does it say for extracurricular?
It says, for free and reduced lunch students, school districts are required to waive any fees for participation in extracurricular activities.
And sports, like some schools charge for sports.
Is a class trip not?
It says, for instance, if the school band took a voluntary trip to Florida to perform in a parade, the school district would be required to pay for the airfare, hotel, and so forth for the free and reduced students in the band.
So would this be considered a voluntary senior class trip? You know?
Well, can't be.
But I think,
sponsored.
Yes, I mean, some schools charge for extracurricular, like sports, you know, to participate,
right?
So.
Well, I know we pay for physicals for some kids, we pay for.
But I think there might be a difference whether
it's
a budgeted money versus a
fundraiser.
Does the school have to pay the fee?
Fill the gap.
I understand that, I think we do. Yeah.
What was that?
Well, I don't know if it says, I think you have to talk to the attorney about that.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Maybe we should find, I mean, it sounds like, and I'm not an attorney, so we should ask, but if they don't raise enough money and they are a free reduced lunch student,
right?
We're
required
to
fill now.
You
can only go on the trip if you pay this fee. It sounds like we're required to pay that fee.
Well,
but I don't.
Through fundraising, we don't know. Fundraising may be something different.
So that's a question.
Right, that's what I'm getting at.
Yeah, if they were short money.
Right.
If they were voluntary trips.
Right. If we cap it.
Well,
if you don't cap it, then you may not have to, because you go to the how much money you've earned. If you've only earned 15 or 10, you only use that much of it. You know what I mean? So if they earn 20 and everybody can go somewhere, then I think we would. If they, but we have to find that out.
Well, I mean, that could equate to class dues, and you couldn't really require somebody to pay class dues if they're getting free meals lunch. You know, because that's over and above what their source of income would be.
You go back to Matt's idea where it's not school sponsored.
I guess just to comment on that, what I mentioned before, as far as I just think it's huge risk and not only liability as far as accountability. If you're involved in a non-school sponsored trip, and I sure the heck would hate to be an advisor, a parent, or whomever managing that money, and not having layers of money and layers of accountability, you know, and all of a sudden some money comes up short and somebody hasn't paid, says they paid, and things that go along with that. I think you're going to have parents and whomever is involved with that running pretty fast to the hills if they think that they're, you know, responsible for the financial end of it. I mean, we have several layers, you know, with any fundraising that takes place now, from the treasurer of the class to the advisors to myself to Ms. Vance to Debbie to, I mean, we're all locked into that. And if there's any gaps with any of us, you know, we get called on the carpet for it. And I just don't think you're going to have all those layers if you were try to go out and raising money without having it under the umbrella of the school. I think it's hugely, a huge risk.
So the system that's in place is something that you're comfortable with?
I am.
There are checks and balances.
Yeah, there are. I mean, and we're not foolproof either. But it is. It's, you know, when you've got five or six layers of people involved and signing off on that, I mean, it's, you don't feel like you're hanging out there by yourself.
Right.
You know, and I think that's important for all of us. As far as any releasing any money, as far as depositing any money, if we release any, it has to go through that reverse process and before an advisor can get any money out of there to pay for something that they need money for.
So it sounds like we're on going. I mean,
well, yeah, I think we're close. I feel like there's been some clarification from a lot of different angles for me. So.
I do too. I think, you know.
Great, but we're not done.
No, I think the policy committee can be.
I think you guys
back with something. Everybody's got to vote. Not everybody's going to be happy at the end of this, guys. I mean,
yeah, but you don't need to just say that first meeting in April we have to have a policy to vote on.
We can have a draft for you guys.
I mean, that's wrong to say, though. You got to have something. Matt Vance said that.
I'm only saying that because, I mean, you guys both mentioned God. I don't remember how this came up. We've been doing it for so long. But
yeah.
That's also, I agree with you. I probably should have said that. But it's also not justification to just keep doing nothing but talking. I mean, at some point.
Oh, that's right. But
and what you can
I think
submit,
more questions came up tonight than answers.
Yeah.
I think we got a lot of answers. Essentially, all you change in the policy is the time that they have to give time come to the for you to the school board to submit and get approval for their trips, and it's close to the date of our neighboring schools. We moved it up further in junior year. Closer, so they have a better time. They should have their money by the end of their junior year. The other schools say the same thing in their policies. So if you compare the other policies to ours, you know, ours needed to be revamped so it wasn't late last notice, so everybody had their money in time, those little things. And it's not a huge lot of changes, I don't think. But I know it's not well liked by the advisors, but it's mostly what the other schools have also done, just to kind of shore things up a bit. Didn't change. There was some talk about capping it, but if you don't cap it, you don't cap it. I mean, that'd be up to you guys. And I agree with Tony. I mean, I don't think people need $40,000. That's a lot of money to get from the community. $40,000 is huge.
I don't think that's the norm, though.
Yeah, I don't know how much they are, but anyway, good luck.
I guess my only suggestion would be wait until we have our new board and see if that board ultimately fund amount of fundraising policy answers to or takes direction from the board. If the new board wants to direct them to bring those two policies back to policy, then we can. If not, then we'll leave it. Yeah.
I have a question. You know, if this is going to go back to policy at some point, obviously it'd be rehashed into a different policy or some kind of amended policy. I had a question in regards for administration to the community service aspect of it. If I'm reading this right, it says, you know, they must fulfill the community service activities schedule each year to go on the class trip, and then it says the overall participation has to be at least 51%. So am I reading it that as long as half the class participates in their community service activity, that counts? Okay. That seems kind of arbitrary to me, to the point where we're saying, you know, kids have to participate in, you know, X amount of fundraising activities, these participation points, but a student could go all 4 years with not participating in any of his class's community service activities and still be eligible for the trip, based on the way we have this policy worded. I would just suggest we policy looks to rework that somehow, because I think that it locks people into doing community service things a certain way, or changes interpretation of community service. You know, I personally see, as my children come through, I'd like to see a class embrace a true community service project, whether it's a senior project that they work for, it's over 4 years, and that could be part of their requirement to go on this trip. But I don't know if we should be locking them into, you have to do two of these a year, or only 51% of the class shows up. I think the other thing that compounds that is, and this is my question for administration, how many hours are required for community service to graduate?
40.
That's separate from this.
40 hours.
40. All right, so, you know, our students are out there. You know, they're doing their job. They're going out and finding community service to do, you know, through their high school career and putting their 40 hours, and we know some of them are putting in a lot more than that. You know, do we need to be putting it as criteria for the class trip as well? And I think that's maybe something, the discussion to have between the administration and maybe the policy committee, and maybe kind of rework that to a bigger picture, community service project. Because like I said, the way it's worded now kind of fails, you know, where, you know, as long as somebody's showing up at every fundraiser and selling their 5 raffle tickets and their mums, they can go on a class trip, but if they blow off, you know, every community service, all 8 of them for 4 years, as long as 51% showed up, they're fine. I think that's kind of a hole in our policy right now.
Hey, Matt. I guess one last question. So for each class, there's an advisor, and is there also a teacher from that class? Or is it just parent advisors or an advisor?
It varies.
Okay.
Ideally, we would get a staff member and parent
advisor.
Usually range from, one right now, we have 1 to 3 people involved. There's not a huge line in many cases for people that are willing to serve as advisors. So that's why it varies, but it works out well if we have some representative from the school and a parent, and oftentimes that person, the employee of the school, is both a parent and an employee of the school.
They serve both roles.
Yeah. But it varies. Right now we've got some with 1 and some with 3.
Now, I think it would make sense. It should be required to have a staff member serve as an advisor to have that school connection.
It sounds good.
I know, but you know,
you don't always have the option. It's
yeah.
Like trying to get a coach.
And I've spoken to, you know, past advisors who said they would never do it again. They love the kids, they love the whole experience, but the fundraising part of it was so daunting and overwhelming. And you wonder, you say there's not a long line, maybe that line changes a little bit.
Yeah.
If, you know, it's not such a daunting task to grab these kids right when they finish their 8th grade year and say, we gotta pick our where we wanna go and how much money we wanna raise and let's get at it.
It's a lot of work, and I understand that. It's not in the teacher's contract either, but it's a lot of work.
Any other questions or comments on this? Moving on for now.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay.
Thank you.
Next to staff, Vicki. All right.
No, you still want continuing business. Right?
Or is there more continuing business?
Yeah, I got some questions.
Okay. You can always send those to Judy and get them on the agenda. I'm not trying to bypass it.
Continue this stuff I've already asked about. Yes.
Okay.
Did the kitchen equipment get put in? She told me last week it's going, last meeting was going in.
It came in.
Yeah.
But it did, it's not installed yet because there are problems with it getting here when they said it was going to get here. So the gas company, who we had on standby for a couple of days, was not able when it finally got here to be here. So we have a date set up March 24th with all the parties involved.
What's that Saturday?
It's a Friday. Friday afternoon, because we have in for the
afternoon. Has there been any word back on the feasibility study of the energy?
No, I haven't heard anything. He's had a couple questions along the way, you know, just some more information I haven't seen before.
And how about the police officer, Judith? Have you talked to him about the grant for the generator?
I spoke to him and said it would take 2 years to get.
Okay. Are they going to pursue it?
Yeah, they said they're going to try it, but it took 2 years to get.
Excuse me.
What was the generator for?
Well, remember we voted to make this an emergency shelter.
Oh, right, okay, yeah.
And the reason to do it was so that they could apply for a grant to get a generator for the school.
It's a federal grant, so it took me 2 years.
Do you know, did he mention anything about having to do a study or anything for the building? Are you aware of the one that was done a couple of years
ago? Yeah, we have
one.
Yeah,
that'll cut out,
help
them a lot.
Mm-hmm.
I had a couple questions too, if I could.
Sure. Yep.
One was the RYBS. Is that going out this week, or is the kids getting in again? Youth Risk Behavior Survey.
Yeah. It is. We are doing it.
It's around this time. Yeah.
Does it? I don't have the date, but there is a date to set up for.
And the other one, I just wondered if they're still going to get the last bullying survey that exit survey for the seniors filled out, and there was some disclosure of like not getting along with peers and that kind of stuff. Are you going to do that again this year? Because that was very formal. I'd like, hopefully that's decreased a little. There was one class that had a hard time getting along, and so hopefully that has decreased. Thank you.
Yeah.
John, can we set up a time maybe after the elections to bring the geothermal back? We all want to, the board, I guess, wanted
yes.
to hear it as
well.
A whole.
I mean, there was an evening that you wanted to present to the board, but I know you had a work thing that night, but the board was this board wanted to all be there.
Okay. So do you want to do it at a board meeting? We don't have to pick a date tonight, but I need to.
I think it sounded like everyone wanted to be there, and they were hoping it could be at the beginning of the hour or two before.
Okay. I don't need to take 20 minutes, it's going to take an hour and a half. I'll find out.
Let's go through the audit, and under estimated actual revenues, there's a line item for student activities, and it earns $1,675. What does that consist of?
I think that is the basketball games.
Entrance fees?
Yeah.
And that just goes into the
general fund? Yeah. Kind of offset any of the costs, building costs, rep costs, all that costs from the night.
Okay. Anything else for continuing?
I did ask one more question, if I could ask Deb. I asked the towns about how much money was given back from the school district to the towns. They said you would know that. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, I do that report every fall for you guys.
Yeah.
But it's 200 and something thousand last year, 240,000, I forget what it was. But I think the question also was, how does it get back to the towns? Because it's not like we write a check back to the towns.
Right, it goes
It goes through, so taxes. They set, it goes through the tax rate setting, basically. Our budget is set. We estimate our revenues. So it's basically the budget minus the revenues not from the town is what we need from the town. So you have your budget minus any revenues, like we get catastrophic aid, federal forest reserve, Medicaid monies, grant monies, things like that. So once you take that into account, that's basically what we need for the town. But then they say, what is the school sending back? What is our unassigned fund balance? And they subtract that from that. Mm-hmm. So basically it lessens it the amount that the town would be paying us for the next year.
It's about 240 for both times, so well, 120.
Well, yeah, so then how it goes back, though, is it goes back based on the formula.
Right. Oh, I know.
So
yeah.
Lincoln gets 65% back, right? 65, 35, and Woods up 35% back.
Yeah.
So it all gets a portion back.
Mm-hmm. We get less back because we don't get cat. Lincoln doesn't cat. I should say we have a cat. Lincoln doesn't get cat.
Yeah, we all do.
Oh, I thought
it comes in. No. No, you're thinking of adequacy.
Oh, adequacy. Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, Vicki.
All right. Heather Krill submitted that Liam Clark will be a calibrating poet for the Poetry Out Loud State Finals at the State House in Concord on Friday the 10th. Good job, Liam. 8 Method students and 1 professor from Plymouth State will work with Heather and her first period 9th grade English class on Mondays and Fridays for the next six weeks, collaborating on a narrative writing project. And as Bob mentioned, it's National Education Read Across America Week, and read, and thank you to the book buddies and guest readers across the grade levels. Karen Shammy submitted, on behalf of our 15 youth and government students, she'd like to thank the Rotary, Booster Club, and PTSA for their continuing support of the program. They're headed to Concord for their first day's orientation on March 18th, and then they go back 2 weeks later for the full program. The kids have written bills, and they're meeting to critique and do further research on them. Thank you, too, to the district who supports them. And last but not least, the Wellness Committee submitted that the middle school's been doing wellness afternoons once a quarter for the past few years, but now they're going to expand that to the high school. This Friday is the first high school wellness event, and all students will choose their activity for 4th period and 5th period, with selections ranging from cardio kickboxing to Tai Chi or healthy snacking or beginner yoga. We're lucky to have staff members that are leading some activities, Dory Whedon, Karen Shammy, Casey Murphy, and Sarah Bowden. And there are also community members from the Lincoln Police, Live a Little Fitness, David Anderson, and Carpe Diem CrossFit are all coming. The hope is that this can become a regular occurring event in high school as well as the middle school. That's it.
Thank you. Any questions for Vicki? Community. Could you say your name also so we can...
Aiden McGinley.
Aiden, how are you? That's right.
Good, how are you?
Good.
On the topic of the senior class trip, I really like what Matt, Vance, John, and Mike have said, and also what Mr. Nelson has said about keeping it within the school. I think it'd be really hard to differentiate being involved with the school. Like he said, when we go to try and fundraise, first thing we say is we're from the junior class, and that's why people donate. They're here to donate to a class from the school. They're not just giving out money to random kids. With doing one night for all the kids, that would be school funded. I think that would work really well. That would take care of a lot of the inclusivity problems that people seem to have. Other than that, I think the percentage-based and participation-based system works fine. If you put in the work to raise the money, you get to go on the trip and have it paid for completely. If you don't, or if you do a fraction of that, you'll chip in a certain amount of money based on what you've done. You completely control whether it's paid for or not, and that's in your hands. And I think that gives, I forget if it was John or Mike who said it, but if you don't do it and you have to pay, that's life. That's going to give you the lesson that if you put in the work, you're going to get the reward. And if you don't, you won't.
Thanks, Aiden.
I'm gonna add to that. I'm Liam Clark. Speaking about doing, getting rid of percentages for participation or whatever it may be. So as it is right now, even with that participation, as in as a requirement, kids still aren't motivated. So if we got rid of that, it wouldn't make much of a difference. That just means that kids now definitely wouldn't have to show up and could just stay home, because kids already do that. We have kids who work, which that's understandable, but we also have kids who just choose not to show up because they just don't want to, which means if we get rid of the participation, they're allowed to do that. And I mean, that's not really teaching life lessons at all. And also, speaking about community service, since we already have to do 40 hours for graduation, I think making more time added with our class fundraisers with community service that we're doing for graduation added for some for the class trip, that's also not going to motivate some of these kids who still aren't going to go. I don't think any class trip has had, or actually, I may be wrong, but I don't think for the recent class trips that we're going to have, or the future ones also, that there will be 100% participation, because there won't be. There will probably be some kids who just stay back simply because they don't want to go. So that's all I have to say about that.
Sure, man. Liam, I have a question for you. So you spoke about the participation, or I don't know the scale. I don't know how it works and how you guys, whether, is it money raised based or is it effort?
No, it's just, it's more of if you're there or not. It also has to do with money, but it's not all based on money. It is not 100% money.
Okay.
So if you sell so many mums, there's a requirement. There's also simply just bringing in a stuffed animal for a drive of some sort, of bringing in a bag of candy for Halloween. And that's very simple. Those things are very simple. I mean, they don't require a lot of money. And also, it's simply just putting in the hours of work. So it's a fine balance of money and just simply doing the work.
Follow up to that. If you raise, so if certain students raise, say, $1,500 each, but the trip that you originally planned was only $1,000, where does the remainder of that money go? Or does the activities on the trip build for those who have raised more money? Do you know what I mean? Do you expand the activities because you've raised more money?
Usually not.
Or does money go to help those who maybe have participated but haven't raised as much money?
Well, I mean, if we already had a set plan and we made more money than that plan, we're not going to expand on that plan.
Okay.
I feel like our class, not specifically our class, but classes wouldn't just expand. I feel like we would do a more community-oriented thing, or maybe just donate the money simply.
Okay.
Just because it's kind of selfish to do that, just because if we have a surplus of money, I don't think that it's necessary to just make our trip even more lavish than it needs to be.
Okay. Thanks, that was helpful. Congratulations on the calibrations.
Thank you.
If I can clarify on that question, it's completely percentage-based on the participation that you put into it. The money is dispersed, money is put amongst the students who participate.
Okay,
afterwards.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys. Anyone else? Pat?
All right. The senior class trip. I don't think it's a spring break. Erin has her opinion, and I'm sorry, Erin, I'm not, you know, that's your opinion, that's fine. I've sat here for many years and listened to these kids come back and state what they've done. And there's always some sort of a learning activity thrown in there on the trip. Now, am I right or am I wrong? I mean, I've always heard that there's been something for them to learn on the trip. All right, these kids aren't going on this trip and going and getting drunk and having wet t-shirt contests and smoking bongs on the beach.
I don't think that's our perception.
I understand, okay? I just want
to make that clear.
Okay, I'm just trying to be a little facetious, okay? I'm just saying, these kids are going, they're having their last time together with their high school class. They're learning a little something and having a little fun as a group. Okay, and I don't think you should take away with them. I think you should just leave it alone. Okay, so that's all I had to say on that. I heard a lot about policies, there should be a policy for this and all. There's no government entity that I've ever seen, or any organization I've ever seen, that can have a law and a policy for every situation that might arise. All right, so there doesn't need to be a policy for everything. Okay, policies are guidelines. All right, you know, not a lot of them is really set in stone. Rules are made to be broken. There's shades of gray everywhere. Okay, so I'm just saying that, you know, I understand you have to have a base, but that's what it is, the base. In regards to the first thing that we discussed tonight about the guns, I'm pretty well versed in guns. I have to be. As a retired police officer, I have to be, because there's a federal law that says that current and retired law enforcement officers can carry a firearm anywhere in all 50 U.S. states, the District of Columbia, and all U.S. territories without regard for current with local law. Okay? That being said, I think it was irresponsible to bring it up in a public meeting that is now being recorded and is going to be posted on the website, okay, and put in the minutes. Because if you all remember when I sat on the board, I was a member of the emergency management team when the state emergency management guy came up. And 91A6, I believe it is, gives you the right to speak about school security matters in a non-public setting. Okay, all you've done now is made something out of something that probably wasn't even an issue because now it's brought out into the public. That being
said, can I respond to that? This is a state law. This is legislation. This isn't a secret.
I get that.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, I get that. But discussing what you want to do for school security issues in regards to that state law should have been done in non-public, in my opinion.
Sure.
Okay? The state law that was signed in, all right, Senate Bill 12, I believe it is.
Yep.
Okay. Didn't do much in New Hampshire, other than to say you don't need a permit. Before the law went into effect, all you needed to do, an individual needed to do, was go to his local police department, fill out an application, pay them the $10, they do a criminal records check on you, and you get a permit, because this New Hampshire was a shall issue state. It means they cannot reject you unless you had something in your criminal background that prevented it. Okay? So now, all those people that had gun permits, they may have been coming into the school forever already. You don't know that. It hasn't changed just because you don't need a permit. New Hampshire was the 12th state to sign a law like that into effect. Okay? There are three others that had the same type of legislation pending. And I think two of them may have passed. Vermont is an additional state that has never had any type of a permitting requirement. All right, and there's no permit at all in Vermont, never has been. Okay, I'm just, you know, you don't need to be giving people ideas about bringing guns to the school, okay? You just sit there, let it go. I don't think it's a major issue. Now the 1,000-foot law, that the superintendent quoted. That's a federal law. Local and state law enforcement officers, unless something has changed, cannot enforce federal law. That has to be a U.S. federal agent that arrests on a federal law. And a 1,000 feet, okay, now, been a while since I went to school, what is it, 5,280 feet in a mile? Okay, that's a little over 0.2 of a mile. You can almost be down to exit 32 and be violating that law. So that means anybody who wants to go from that end of town to this end of town or over to Conway is violating the law if they drive down Main Street or drive down Pollard Road because you're not 1,000 feet from the school. It's an unenforceable law that, to my knowledge, nobody's ever been arrested for. It's an add-on charge once they find somebody doing something around the school and if they've been caught with a firearm. I think if you just let it go, you don't have to make all sorts of rules. Nothing has changed, okay, other than the fact that you don't need a permit. Like I said, anybody in New Hampshire that doesn't have a criminal record could have got a permit anyway. And they may have been in this school and nobody knows it. It's not the people who are obeying the laws that are committing crimes. It's the people that aren't obeying the laws that are committing crimes. And I'll tell you, the same records check that you did to get a gun permit prior, or still, because you can still get a gun permit if you want, for reciprocity with the other states that we have agreements with, okay, is the same background check that you have to do when you go in and get a gun, when you go in to buy a gun. So if I go into Woodstock Police to get my gun permit every 4 years, now it's going to be 5, all right, I fill out an application, he does a background check on me through all the law enforcement computers, I qualify, I get my permit. If I go down to buy a gun, that permit means nothing, because you don't need a permit in New Hampshire to buy a gun, even before the law. I go down there, the dealer is required to do the exact same check by calling the state police, giving him my name and information.
Yeah, I don't think, what is this? I don't think we,
I'm just saying, let it go. I think it's a non-issue.
It's like a two-minute conversation. I mean, okay.
Well, you guys just talked for over an hour on the school trip, so. Yep. You know, I think I'm, you know.
I'm not trying to be rude at all. That's
okay. I'm just saying, let it go. Don't make a mountain out of a molehill that isn't there.
Can can I just make something clear, just because of what you said? I don't think there was an in-depth conversation on our security procedures in the building and how we handle certain situations. So we didn't present it that way. We acknowledge that this legislation that's passed that may have changed a few things. I don't think we're any of the conversations going to alarm anybody. But I appreciate your, and some of it was very helpful and informative.
Any other comments from the community? Bobby?
Oh, okay, I'll let them go.
Bobby, Donnie?
You go. I just wanted to say that when the fundraising cuts were first made to the fundraising policy, it was our class, and we haven't even cycled through yet, so you don't even know if those even worked yet, and you're already trying to change something else. As far as community service, with our class, that all counts towards participation for everyone. And graduation week at school, and Bob can attest to this because he's seen it many years, we buy lunches for the kids, breakfast for the kids, and it's all the kids. It's not pick and choose, it's everyone. There's never been any discrimination. And the kids bond through any fundraising that they've done. We've always gone above and beyond. We will take kids, we will buy things and bring them in for kids and let them get credit. We will say, I will buy from you if you just ask me. So everyone has more than enough opportunity to participate and be a part of it.
And for kids that have a hard time selling, we have buddy systems. And like we said, we'll buy from them. I take away from Liam to buy for other kids, from other kids. It's our class, we all work together, and they don't just get points for selling things. They can come in and work the door selling tickets. You know, that's not making them buy anything. That's just their time.
That was helpful for me to know.
Okay.
Joe Bossi, you had a comment?
Yeah, well, seeing as how my name was brought up tonight about everything as far as the emergency lights and contacting the...
Just to clarify, no, I don't think your name was brought up. You brought it up yourself?
Yep.
Okay.
Well, no, it was brought up. So, and I'm not hiding anything.
No, I know you're
and
not.
I, I didn't go call. I didn't go call. I met up with him at the dump. I want to back up a little bit as far as why this happened. There's been dozens of emergency lights that have been out. The night of the senior games, we had a complete full gym. We had exchange students, buses of them. Every spot in that gym was, seats were full. The whole northeast section of that gym had no emergency light, wasn't working. It wasn't even there on the wall, which it hadn't been for many games prior. But that, with everybody in there, is what made me finally go say something. And it's been since fixed. The reason I went there, I'm not real comfortable with going to administration because, as Judith just said, it kind of gets swept under the rug and hidden. Oh, it's just a ball boat. It's not just a ball boat. You had an entire gym full of people. They couldn't get off the bleachers if the power went out. It wasn't even there. That's negligence. That's not just a ball boat. And the list goes on. As far as the fire extinguishers, Primex used to make me sign them off. Every fire extinguisher in both of these buildings has a tag attached to it. It has sign-off dates on the back of it. Every month, you're supposed to physically take that fire extinguisher out. Some of them have to be turned up to stir the silica in them. You make sure the pressures are right. You initial them, and you say that's fine. If public safety isn't an issue for you guys here, not only is that negligent, it's shameful that we shouldn't have to go through and do that anymore. And as far as somebody from the public contacting about the gym, it's hard for me to come in here as a chaperone to go to the ball games and stuff like that as a former director. When I'm in there in a new gym and it's raining on me all over the floor as I'm speaking to people, the stuff under the bleachers, there's graffiti on the new bleachers, and I look up and there's a 5-gallon bucket full of water, 40 pounds of water, strapped over my head in the gym, 30 feet up.
Joe, if I could just for a moment.
That's safety, though.
Yeah, but if I could just if you're going to go through a punch list of...
No, that's it. That's okay, it. Just I wanted to be clear why I contacted somebody else.
If we entertain that, though, we're...
I want to hear this stuff,
although
too.
Without... I mean, we're not naming employees, but...
No, I didn't name anybody.
I know, but even though you didn't, I don't think there's anyone in this room that doesn't know the person or people you're referring to. We can't entertain those conversations. But
I'm telling you why I contacted people. It was brought up that the public contacted the fire chief, and I want to tell you some of the reasons why I did it.
Okay.
That's all.
Okay, thank you.
And he has a right to share his concerns about this, the condition of the school.
Oh, I'm not.
As a public person.
I'm not saying
he doesn't,
but I mean, we've never entertained any conversation where we can identify an employee for...
I didn't identify anybody. No. I never even mentioned that.
But without... You don't have to... It doesn't. Just by not naming their name doesn't mean you haven't identified them. I mean, I don't think...
I identified a situation that was detrimental to over 50 people in that gym. It was detrimental.
Could I ask that you share... I don't know if there's more on the list, but I would like, if you would, to share it with Judy. I know that you...
I was going to read the whole thing tonight, but instead I was just going to write a letter and...
I mean, it would...
I wasn't even going to speak tonight until it was brought up. I didn't want people in here thinking that, oh, I'm running to the fire chief. I met up with him at the dump.
That's fine, but
And this was finally the thing that sent me over the edge, with all those people in the gym. And then you go back and look, and it's not just an isolated incident.
No, I appreciate it. And I mean, if you would share that with Judy, I think it would be helpful. I think you made a statement about Judy sweeping things under the rugs. I don't think you said that. That you do that, but
well, no, it was just a comment about, oh, it was just a ball boat. It wasn't just a ball boat.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Okay.
Can I comment on that?
Sure.
As in regards to the two points, as far as the emergency lighting and the fire extinguishers, clearly the fire chief came over here and inspected that. Can the board get the report from the fire chief as far as what he found?
That's good. Exactly, and I was repeating what I was told by the fire chief because I was not in the loop.
Right. I'd like to comment. None of this has been brought to my attention either.
No. I mean, I asked that you could share his report or whatever communication you had. I mean, do you have that offhand as far as what he found with the emergency lights or, you know, as far as X amount were out?
Yeah, he has stated to me that's what was, it was two emergency lights and they had been fixed.
Two, okay. You probably don't know, but...
No, I can certainly
just
ask
how many there are.
Because he has to report it.
And then obviously I don't know if procedure has changed since Mr. Rossi worked here to now. As far as the fire extinguishers, I fully believe him when he says he had to do this. You know, if we can just get verification that that's not the way it's done now. That'd be great. Because we do take public, the safety as a major issue, and I feel your concern because I do believe that you're acting in the best interest of anybody that comes in the buildings because I know you as a person, regardless
it's hard for me to separate it.
I think we should follow up on that and see what the report
was. And I would encourage other public to come to you and to Bob first. They're paying for this building. They look at the building. They have every right to step up and say, this isn't done properly. There's too much. You know, I've heard some stuff too, but I didn't, so I think I encourage public to do that. I think it's very important.
Sally?
To go back to the fundraising and the class trip, and I've heard you say, and I respect all your opinions, but you were talking about going back to policy again in April. I would like you to be mindful of the junior class in that their time and their deadlines are getting close, and if you start putting caps on now, you really are affecting them, and I would just like to ask that you please, unlike the first policy change that did impact them without a lot of consideration for how it impacted them, that you look at them as possibly being grandfathered, and then really taking the data from the committees and looking and making informed decisions based on that rather than just discussing it, going back to the people and understanding how the process works. And if it's different from class to class, then maybe that's where the focus needs to be, Every class, it is the same, rather than caps, but how you earn points or how you do things. Because this class, I mean, whatever Keelan sells, he doesn't have to sell a lot, but I know it helps everybody, and I buy from whoever asks. But
I would consider grandfathering them. Your fundraising change this last time went right across the board and did impact them a lot.
Yeah, and I, just to go back on what I said, I'm not saying it is going back. I just, I don't know where we're going from here.
I mean, probably is, but I would like you to be mindful of them and perhaps grandfathering them as seniors.
You know, not grandfathering, if that happened, wasn't. That's an omission.
But it's impact.
I would like to think that if there's any other change made, that there'll be some grandfathering.
I really feel it was, perhaps it was an oversight, but there's been no apology to how it impacted the kids. And we are all here for the kids and what's best for them. And they've been working really hard, and those changes did impact them. Mm-hmm. And I fear this one will as well. Unless they're grandfathered this time. That's how I feel.
Thanks, Sarah.
Yeah.
Any other comments?
I guess I was kind of to piggyback on a couple of the comments is that I know you had brought up about the travel agent, and I know that was a huge, huge expense when Judy and I looked at it, and we brought that up. I would just like to, like, you know, look at, let this class cycle through, or one or two classes cycle through, and see how much money is actually being raised compared to the previous years. I know that when I was an advisor, the discrimination comment, I was a little bit offended because I know that we included each and every student. Judy and I went above and beyond including each and every student, and our students went above and beyond including their classmates, including them in activities, including them in fundraisers, including them in winter carnival, in graduation, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And I look at, you know, my sons in the junior class, they do a phenomenal job, including everybody, going above and beyond. You know, like they said, I offered Wyoming Advisor, we all want the kids to do the best that they can. And I was just a little hurt that the discrimination thing came up, because I know there are students that do struggle, whether it's, you know, at home, in school, what the situation is, and I feel that the adults and the advisors go above and beyond. And I just want, as Sally said, just to look at the whole thing and just consider before we just jump into another policy change and how it's gonna work.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay, seeing no more comments, John has requested through Judy that we have a non-public tonight. John, you know which RSA it is for what the... That's the basic. What's the general guidelines? Like what's...
RSA 91.
Yeah, that is what it is.
Okay.
Yes, I do.
Thank you.
Right, thank you, everybody.
Hold them. Aaron. Tony.
Where are we going?
Not 100% sure. We don't.